Okay, so hello, hello nurses and hello midwives. So welcome po sa ating YouTube channel and welcome na din po sa ating online event ngayong gabi, which is our rationalization for obstetrics and pediatrics. Bago po tayo magsimula sa ating rationalization, gusto ko lamang pong ipangabot ang aking pasasalamat sa ating mga subscribers na nagbibigay suporta sa ating channel by means of giving and sending their super chat and super stickers. Okay, so sa mga nakarang events natin sa ating channel, gusto pong pasalamatan sina Ma'am Maria Efleda Andes, Ma'am April Sige, Ma'am Lenny Valdez, Ma'am Joanne Serrano, Ma'am Dominic Simbol, Ma'am Ann Santos, Ma'am Joanna Agawin, kay Ma'am Jalila, at saka kay Ma'am Ann Santos, Ma'am Liza Bernal, Nelia Criza Katubay, kay Sir Resti Makalisang, Ma'am Marian Hazel Cantos, Ma'am Diane Kenneth De La Rosa, at kay Ma'am Fat Mama. And maraming salamat din po kay Ma'am Joanne Serrano, Ma'am Carmina De Vera, Catherine Nodado Paclibar, kay Ma'am Crystal Vera Litang, sa Cancer Gaming Unicorn YouTube channel account, kay Sir Ron Pascual, Yan Casabar, Gab Masepekina, kay Sir Rizaldo Bohol, Jonalyn Bertolano, Mary Joyce Dumagit, Where the Flores YouTube channel account, kay Ma'am Evelyn Paris, kay Ma'am Ann Santos, Shefau Nogot, Ma'am Bern, Ma'am Hazel Caronan, Ma'am Jocelyn Okmer, Ma'am Catherine Nodado Paclibar, Mary Joy Ferriol, April Alinyo, Sir Gregs RM, Faye Dugan, Ann Santos, Jan Vincent Doong, kay Ma'am Sweet Love, at kay Ma'am Jima Quint Lotz Shanko at Aristotle Tonido, at syempre kay Sir Holyo Bautista. Maraming salamat po sa inyong mga binigay na super chat and super stickers. And maraming salamat din po sa mga ating mga subscribers and mga nanonood po ng ating mga YouTube channel videos na hindi nag-skip po ng ating mga advertisement. Maraming salamat po, at sa ganung paraan po ay nakakapagbigay suporta na rin po tayo sa ating YouTube channel. So ngayong gabi, ang ating pong gagawin ay irarasyo po natin ang ating obstetrics and pediatrics. And sa mga susunod na mga araw, meron po ulit tayong mga events like your psychiatric nursing and medical surgical nursing exam. Again, so para hindi po tayo masyadong matagalan, mag-uumpisa na po tayo sa ating online rationalization. Again, maraming salamat po sa mga nagbibigay at magbibigay suporta sa ating YouTube channel. Maraming salamat po. Tayo pang sisimula na sa ating online rationalization.
Maybe
1. Okay, so let's begin our rationalization with our question number 1. An adolescent seen in the healthcare clinic has been diagnosed with endometriosis. The client asked the clinic nurse to describe this condition. So which response should the nurse provide? A. It always causes infertility. B. It causes the cessation of menstruation. C. It is the presence of tissue outside the uterus. Or letter D. It is also known as the primary dysmenorrhea. Okay. So, in our question number 1, ang tanong po dito is about your endometriosis. So, pag sinabi po natin endometriosis, that is the ectopic growth or the growth of your endometrial cell outside the uterus. And that is common in your ovaries. So, ovaries po ang pinaka-common sa itong inyong endometriosis. So, makikita mo sa ovaries ng mga babae kapag meron silang endometriosis, yung presence of chocolate cyst,
or yung tinatawag natin na gunshot powder lesion. Again, ulitin ko, chocolate cyst or the gunshot powder lesion ang makikita natin sa kanilang ovaries kapag meron po silang endometriosis. And the three most common signs and symptoms of your endometriosis are the following. Meron kang dysmenorrhea, which is nangyayari po yan or na nag-occur po yan 1 to 2 weeks before your onset of your menstruation. Ano pa? Meron din tayo tinatawag ditong chronic pelvic pain. And yung pangatlo is the dyspareunia or the painful sexual intercourse. Okay? So pag sinabi po sa ating board exam na endometriosis, hindi naman po siya laging nagkukos ng infertility. So mali po yung ating letter A. So the correct answer here in your question number 1 is letter C, because endometriosis is the ectopic growth of your endometrial cell outside the uterus. Yan po yung ating tamang sagot. So merong nag-grow na endometrial cell sa kanyang ovaries, which is outside the uterus. So dapat sa uterus mo lang nagtutubo or tumutubo yung mga endometrial cells. So dito sa endometriosis, tumubo po siya sa outer part of your uterus. Example is sa ovaries ng mga babae. Again, so ang treatment po dyan is hormonal replacement therapy. So more on your contraceptive drugs, and we have also your surgery kapag ipapatanggal po ng babae. Okay? So again, so question number 1, the correct answer here is letter C. Okay, the next question number 2. The patient asked Nurse Gina, when could you hear the fetal heart of my baby? Which of the following should be the best answer of Nurse Gina? A. 9th month, B. 5th month, C. 3rd month, or D. 1st month. Okay, so take note na yung puso ni baby ay pumipitik na po yan as early as the 1st month of life. Pero hindi pa yung naririnig ng kahit na anong device. So take note that you're a fetal heartbeat can be audible with your Doppler devices as early as 8 weeks to 12 weeks gestation, okay? So, average of 10 weeks. So, 8 to 12 weeks, pwede mo nang ma-detect yung kanyang fetal heart tone by means of Doppler device, pero hindi pa siya audible with the ears of your nurses or midwives, okay? So, kailan mo siya pwede mapakinggan using your stethoscope or mga standard fetoscope? So, pwede mo po siya mapakinggan at 18 weeks to 20 weeks. So, 20 weeks, maririnig mo na yung kanyang fetal heart tone using your stethoscope. So, 20 weeks is 5th month of your pregnancy. So, the correct answer here in your question number 2 is letter B. So, 5th month, pwede mo nang marinig yung ating fetal heart tone using your stethoscope o yung tatawag natin na standard fetoscope. And take note, with your normal range of your fetal heart tone, it should be 120 to 160 beats per minute. Okay? Mas mabilis sa 160, that is a sign of fetal tachycardia. And fetal tachycardia is the earliest sign of your fetal distress. And kapag mas mababa naman sa 120 or the fetal bradycardia, that is the late sign of your fetal distress. So dapat alam nyo din yung ating normal range ng ating fetal heart tone, which is 120 to 160 beats per minute, okay? So 120 to 160 beats per minute, that is the normal fetal heart tone, and that can be audible at 20 weeks or 5 months pregnancy. So letter B is the correct answer here. Okay, the next question number 3. Patient Ashley, who is ordered for diagnostic pelvic ultrasound, asks what preparation she will take. Appropriate preparation for this procedure include A. Explanation of the procedure, B. NPO 6 hours before, C. Informed consent, or D. Voiding. So ano pong sagot ninyo sa ating question number 3? So pelvic ultrasound po yung ating tinatanong dito. Ano daw yung appropriate na preparation? So take note, so eliminated dito yung ating letter B kasi hindi naman po natin ina-NPO yung nanay bago po siya magpa-pelvic ultrasound. Usually pwede naman po siyang kumain at uminom bago yung ating procedure. So mali po ang ating letter B. Next na i-eliminate natin dito na choice is letter C, informed consent. Bakit informed consent? Kasi ang informed consent, kailangan po natin yan sa mga procedure, especially kapag ito ay mga invasive procedures sa obstetrics like your amniocentesis. E itong pelvic ultrasound, non-invasive procedure po to, so hindi po ito kailangan ng informed consent. So letter C is also eliminated. And next, letter D, voiding daw. So kailangan daw umiinom ni nanay bago yung procedure. Mali po yan kasi pinapainom po natin mga buntis na nanay ng 1 liter of water or 1 to 2 liters of water bago po yung ating procedure. And i-maintain po nila yung full bladder kasi it will serve as your transluminant for ultrasound. So kailangan pong full bladder ni nanay para ma-distinguish natin yung kanyang pelvic organ sa kanyang urinary bladder. So there's a need for a full bladder in your ultrasound. So sasabihin mo si nanay na huwag umihi hanggat hindi pa natatapos yung ating procedure. So the best answer here in your question number 3, nurses and midwives, is letter A, to explain the procedure to the mother. Okay? So A is the best answer for question number 3. Okay, then next question number 4, the labor progress and the physician performed amniotomy. Nurse Faith should first assess for A, bladder distension, B, maternal blood pressure, C, cervical dilatation, or D, fetal heart rate pattern. Okay. So sa ating question number 4, kapag sinabing amniotomy, amniotomy is the artificial rupturing of your bag of water or your amniotic fluid membrane. So, pinaputok mo yung panubigan ng nanay. So, take note na yung ating panubigan o yung ating amniotic fluid, dyan po nagpo-float yung baby at yung kanyang umbilical cord. So, kapag meron po tayong rupturing of your bag of water, possible po na ma-dislodge yung kanyang umbilical cord at mauna po siya sa birth canal. And upon na bumaba si baby or yung tatawag natin na descent of the head of the baby, pwedeng madaganan ni baby yung kanyang umbilical cord, causing your fetal distress. Okay? At pwedeng mag-cause yun ng fetal distress, causing your increase or decrease of your fetal heart tone. So, one of your first assessment should be the fetal heart tone. So, hindi lang po sa amniotomy, kundi pati yung ating rupture of your bag of water normally or naturally, dapat ang ating priority dyan na i-assess is your fetal heart tone, okay? Kasi pwedeng ma-distress si baby by the cord compression. So, wala pong relationship yung ating blood pressure ni nanay sa pagputok ng kanyang panubigan. So, hindi po makakapekto yung rupture bag of water sa kanyang blood pressure. So, hindi po magkakaroon dyan si nanay ng hypotension. Letter D is the best answer here in question number 4. Again, so pag merong ruptured bag of water, natural man yan or artificial rupture, dapat ang i-priority natin lagi is si fetal heart tone. Kasi nga, pwede mag-cause siya ng fetal distress caused by your cord compression, by your cord prolapse. Okay? So, letter C is the correct answer here. So, ayan. So, medyo madali pa po yung ating matanong dito sa ating obstetrics and gynecology. So, again, so letter D ang sagot natin sa ating question number 4. So, sa lahat po naman nagbibigay ng ating super chat and super stickers, maraming salamat po. So, mag-send lamang po kayo na mag-send ng ating super chat and super stickers as a support po sa ating channel. So, maraming salamat sa mga nagbigay at magbibigay ng ating super chat and super stickers sa ating channel. Okay, the next question number 5. A newly hired nurse was asked by the nurse supervisor about her concern and what are the considered ideal fetal positions for a healthy delivery? A. Right occipital posterior with no flexion. B. Right occipital posterior with full flexion. C. Left transverse anterior in moderate flexion. Or letter D. Left sacro anterior with full flexion. So in your question number 5, ang tinatanong po dito is the ideal fetal position for a healthy delivery. So mag-eliminate muna tayo dito sa ating option. So tanggal una yung ating letter D kasi left sacro anterior is a breech presentation baby. So mali po yung kanyang fetal position kasi breech yung kanyang presentation. So mali na po yun. Left sacro anterior is a breech presentation. Although na naka full flexion pa yan, breech po yan and that is not ideal for a healthy delivery. So next, letter C. Tanggal din yung ating letter C kasi left transverse anterior is your shoulder presentation or oblique presentation baby. So mali din ang letter C kasi nga that is your left transverse anterior is your shoulder or your transverse lie baby. Mali din po yan, hindi po yan magiging healthy yung delivery. So between letter A and letter B, ang tamang sagot po dito is letter B, okay? So actually dito sa ating question number 5, meron pong nangyaring typographical error siguro dito kasi nga yung letter A at letter B, mali din po dapat silang pareho kasi nga right occipital posterior po ang nakalagay dito, mga occipital posterior. So take note that in obstetrics, the normal and the most ideal fetal position should be occipital anterior po dapat. OA is okay. Tanda niyan, OA, occipital anterior. Basta OA, yun po yung pinaka-ideal and pinaka-okay na position ni baby for a healthy delivery. Kasi pag OP-OP ang ating mga positions, it can cause your severe back discomfort and prolonged labor process. So, hindi po sila ideal for healthy delivery. Actually, itong question number 5 natin ay makikita natin sa NCLEX, okay? Kung saan same po sila ng tanong at mga choices maliban sa letter B, okay? So, yung letter B kasi natin is right occipital posterior with full flexion, which is yung nasa NCLEX question is right occipital anterior with full flexion. At yun po yung pinaka-the best answer sa ating NCLEX question. So dito, yan din ang isasagot natin kasi hindi mo naman pwedeng isagot yung ating letter A, letter C, and letter D kasi hindi naman po sila ideal din, okay? So take note, yung letter C kasi that is your shoulder presentation baby or naka-oblique lang yung baby and yung letter D naman that is a breech presentation baby and that is not ideal fetal position and presentation. So the best answer in your question number 5 is letter B. Kasi nga, full flexion pa dito si baby. So, pag sinabi kasi natin full flexion, that is best ideal position. Kasi pag full flexion kasi yung head ni baby, mas madali po yung paglabas ng ulo niya. Kasi the smallest diameter of the fetal head, which is the suboccipital phlegmatic or the 9.5 centimeter size of the head of the baby, is the one which is comes first in the birth canal. So, it comes first in the birth canal. So, mas mabilis po yung paglabas ng ulo ni baby kapag ito ay full flexion. Okay? So, sa A, sa C, at saka sa D, mali po yung tatlong yun. So, best answer natin dito is letter B. Na dapat itong letter B na to is right occipito anterior with full flexion similar na nasa NCLEX book. Okay? Sa nasa NCLEX question and answer. So, letter B is the correct answer still in your question number 5. So, pag sinabi kasi natin fetal position, that is the relationship of the fetal presenting part to the specific quadrant of the maternal pelvis. Ulitin ko lang, basta OA, occipito anterior ang ibig sabihin nun. Basta OA ang nasa hulihan, that is the ideal position. Kasi OA is okay. And kapag OP yung nababasa mo sa board exam, occipito posteriors, hindi po yun ideal kasi it causes your severe back discomfort and longer labor process sa nanay. So, the best answer pa rin dito is letter B. So, ito po yung tanong na sinasabi ko na nasa NCLEX. Again, so para mas mabilis at mas madali nyo matandaan yung ating fetal position, yung ideal tsaka non-ideal fetal position, take note, OA is occipito anterior and OA is okay. And kapag OP naman, OP is occipito posterior and OP is O painful. Bakit O painful? Kasi it causes severe back pain or back discomfort and it causes your prolonged labor process. Okay? So, tandaan nyo po yan. OA is okay, OP is O painful. Okay, so next, number 6. After the successful vaginal delivery, medication was ordered to be given immediately. The supervisor reassured the newly hired nurse that everything will be fine because the medication will A. promote vasoconstriction of uterine muscles, B. hastens uterine contractility and control bleeding, C. facilitate the return of pre-pregnancy vital signs, or D. promote vasodilation of uterine muscles. So, take note, after delivery, ang pinaka-common na gamot na binibigay natin dito is your oxytocin drug or mga uterine stimulant drugs like your oxytocin and the methergine or the methyl ergonovine. But take note that the first line uterotonic drug is your oxytocin drug or the syntocinone. Okay? Kasi yun po yung pinaka-safest na uterine stimulant. Okay? So take note na ang ating oxytocin, ang kanyang function is to enhance and to stimulate your uterine muscles to contract, thereby it prevents your postpartum hemorrhage or your postpartum bleeding. So, in your question number 6, the correct answer here is letter B. Although sa ating letter A na yung ating oxytocin ay nagkukos ng ating vasoconstriction of your uterine muscle, hindi po yun yung primary effect ng oxytocin kung bakit ay nagbibigay ng gamot na yun. So, the best answer here is letter B. It hastens your uterine contractility and it controls your postpartum bleeding para maiwasan po natin yung ating hemorrhage. And take note also that oxytocin must be given only with your appropriate dosage. So, dapat magbigay ka lang ng 10 units to 30 units of your oxytocin. Okay? And one of your nursing responsibility and midwifery responsibility is to monitor or to check the blood pressure of your patient before giving your oxytocin drug like your methergine and your oxytocin drug. Bakit? Kasi it can cause your adverse reaction, hypertension, kapag po nagbigay po tayo ng mga gamot like your uterotonic drugs, oxytocin and methergine. Kapag sudden naman na binigay natin yung ating oxytocin, it can also cause your sudden hypotension. So, monitor the blood pressure of your patient before and after giving your oxytocin drug. Again, so number one function or number one purpose of giving of this drug is to hasten uterine contractility and to control bleeding, thereby it prevents your postpartum hemorrhage. So letter B is the correct answer for question number 6. Okay, the next question is question number 7. Using Apgar score, Nurse Mika should bear in mind that this method of evaluating newborn's condition is used at how many minutes after birth? Okay, so A, 1 to 10, B, 1 to 3, C, 1 to 7, or D, 1 to 5 minutes. Okay, so take note, Apgar scoring system. So, Apgar scoring system was developed by Dr. Virginia Apgar and that is used to evaluate the adaptation or the adjustment of the newborn into the extrauterine life. That is the number one purpose of your APGAR scoring, para ma-evaluate natin kung nakakapag-adapt ba si baby outside the uterus. Okay? So actually, ang ating APGAR scoring is pine-perform po natin yan within the first minute of life, and next is the 5 minutes of life. So 1 to 5 minutes po yung ating performance of APGAR scoring. So the correct answer here is 1 to 5 minutes. Okay, 1 to 5 minutes pong sagot natin dyan, and that is letter D. So, under your APGAR parameters, we have your APGAR mnemonic. So, A for your appearance, P for your pulse, G for your gray maze, A for your activity, and R for your respiration. So, take note, APGAR stands for your appearance, pulse, gray maze, activity, and respiration. So, the most important or the most sensitive indicator in your APGAR scoring is the heart rate of the newborn, okay? And the least sensitive indicator is the color of the newborn. So, pinaka-importante po dito is to assess the pulse or the heart rate of the newborn. So, take note nyo po yan. So, heart rate is the most sensitive indicator in your APGAR scoring system. So, pag meron po tayong tanong sa board exam na highest possible score sa APGAR, your answer is 10. But commonly, most of your newborn has a score of 9 because of your acrocyanosis or yung ating bluish extremity with pink body. And that is due to your sluggishness of your peripheral circulation of the newborn. Kaya maraming mga bata na nakakakuha lang ng 9 at hindi yung perfect score na 10. Okay? So that is your APGAR scoring system. Again, it is usually done within the first minute of life and after 5 minutes of life. And that is used to assess for the general adaptation of the newborn or the adjustment of the newborn outside the extrauterine life. So letter D is the correct answer for question number 7. Okay, so next question is number 8. Which of the following statement is not an indication for any uterine stimulants like your oxytocin? A. Pre-inducting cervical ripening, B. Controlling postpartum bleeding, C. Inducing or augmenting labor, or letter D. It manages an incomplete abortion. Okay? So, take note, not an indication po ang tinatanong dito. So, eliminate natin yung ating letter B kasi nga oxytocin is primarily used to enhance contraction of the uterus to prevent and to control postpartum hemorrhage or postpartum bleeding. Kasi nga, yung letter B, indication po yan ng paggamit ng oxytocin or any uterine stimulant. So, eliminated po ang ating letter B. Ano pa? Minsan, ang ating mga uterine stimulants like oxytocin ay ginagamit din natin yan to induce or to augment labor, especially kapag meron po tayong mga condition like your dystocia of labor, kung saan nagkakaroon po tayo doon ng hypotonic uterine contractions. So, ginagamitan din natin yun ng oxytocin. So, tanggal din yung ating letter C. Okay? So, between your letter A and letter D, the correct answer here is letter A, pre-inducting cervical ripening. Kasi hindi naman po yan indication for your uterine stimulant used like your oxytocin. So, oxytocin and metrogene will not ripen the cervix. Tandaan nyo yan. So, A is the correct answer. So, oxytocin and metrogene or any uterine stimulants are also used to manage an incomplete abortion or any pregnancy with retention. Okay? So, tandaan nyo yan. Pag may retention sa loob, pwede natin gamitin yung ating oxytocin para i-contract ang uterus ni nanay at para ma-expel yung mga retained products of your pregnancy. So, letter A is the correct answer. So, that is not an indication for use of your any uterine stimulants like your oxytocin drug. Okay? Okay, so next question number 9. Simultaneous with the oxytocin drip in the left arm is the prescribed intravenous lidocaine or the xylocaine. Nurse Laika should dilute the concentrated solution of lidocaine at the right arm with which solution? A. 5% dextrose in water, B. Normal saline 0.99%, C. Normal saline 0.45%, or letter D. Lactated Ringer's solution. So, itong question number 9 natin ay lumabas na po ito sa board exam. And ito po ay napaka-similar and similar talaga siya sa ating Saunders Q&A na nasa chapter 6, page 97 ng libro. Okay? So, ang sagot po doon is letter A, 5% dextrose in water. So, in your lidocaine, your concentrated lidocaine solution should be diluted first with your 5% dextrose in water. So, yun po yung ating sagot dyan. So, A po yan kasi makikita po yung mismong tanong na yan sa ating Q&A sa Saunders chapter 6, page 97 ng libro. So, letter A, 5% dextrose in water daw ang gagamitin natin to dilute the concentrated solution of your lidocaine, not your normal saline 0.99% or the normal saline 0.45%. Hindi po yun yung masagot. So, A is the best answer for question number 9. So, ito po yung tanong na matatagpuan sa ating chapter 6, page 97 ng Saunders Q&A. Okay, so next, number 10 question. Ophelia mentioned that she can experience uterine squeezing. So, which of the following signs of normal pregnancy should the nurse consider? A. Braxton Hicks contraction, B. Hagar sign, C. Ballotment, or D. Goodell sign. So, the correct answer here is letter B, Braxton Hicks contraction. Very obvious po yan kasi yan yung ating uterine squeezing, that is the contraction. So, it is the practice labor contraction kung tawagin natin, okay? So, Braxton Hicks contraction is under your probable sign of your pregnancy. Probable po yan sa mga signs of pregnancy, and that is your uterine squeezing felt by the mother. So, Braxton Hicks contraction or the practice labor contraction. So, it usually occurs anytime during your pregnancy, pero common po yan, 15 weeks gestation. Common na po yan na nag-o-occur lagi yung ating Braxton Hicks contraction. So, sa letter B natin, Hagar sign, that is the bluish discoloration of the lower uterine segment or the changes in texture of your lower uterine segment. So, basta nag-change ang consistency ng lower uterine segment, that is the Hagar sign. At pag sinabi naman po natin na Chadwick sign is yung ano naman yun, bluish discoloration ng vagina at saka cervix. Again, so the bluish discoloration of the vagina and the cervix or the purplish discoloration of the vagina and cervix is known as the Chadwicks. Pag sinabi mo naman ballotment is the rebound tenderness of the fetal head upon palpation of your nurses or midwives in the maternal abdomen. And ito namang si Goodell's. Goodell's is the ripening of the cervix or the softening of the cervix. So you can feel it via your internal examination, and you can feel a butters of cervix or just like the consistency of your earlobe. Okay? And that is your probable sign also of your pregnancy. Again, so Hagar sign, the change in consistency of the lower uterine segment. Chadwick sign is the bluish or purplish discoloration of the cervix and the vagina. Dalawa po yung pwedeng mag-discolor doon, cervix and vagina. And pag sinabi naman natin ballotment, it is the rebound tenderness of the fetal head upon palpation. And if we say Goodell sign is the softening of the cervix like butter and your earlobe softness. Okay? So the correct answer here is letter A, Braxton Hicks contraction. And that is a probable sign of your pregnancy. Okay, then next question, number 11. When planning care for a laboring woman whose membranes have ruptured, the nurse recognizes that the woman's risk for which has increased. A. Intrauterine infection, B. Hemorrhage, C. Precipitous labor, or D. Supine hypotension. So, dito sa ating question number 11, meron po tayong ruptured membrane. So, pag nag-rupture po yung membrane, yung amniotic membrane, nagkakaroon na po tayo dito ng open entry ng ating mga microorganism na pwede mag-cause ng infection. So, maternal infection and your fetal infection, lalo na kapag ito ay prolonged rupture membrane po yan. So, there is an increased risk of your intrauterine infection. So, walang kinalaman dito yung hemorrhage kasi kapag nag-rupture ang membrane, wala naman pong nangyayaring hemorrhage or bleeding dyan nakasama. So, pwede ding mag-cause yan ng onset of your active phase of labor, pero hindi po yan mag-cause ng precipitous labor. Pag sinabi kasi natin precipitous labor, that is the less than 3 hours of your labor process. And letter D, supine hypotension. So, ang supine hypotension, it is not caused by your ruptured membrane. Ang possible na mag-cause ng supine hypotension is the supine lying position of the mother causing your compression of your vena cava. Yan yung tinatawag natin na vena cava syndrome or the supine hypotensive syndrome. So, malabong mangyari na magkaroon ng hypotension si nanay kasi hindi naman related yung amniotic fluid sa kanyang blood volume. So, kahit na madrain yung amniotic fluid, hindi po babagsak yung blood volume ni nanay. So, malabong magkakaroon ng changes sa kanyang blood pressure like your hypotension. So, in your question number 11, there is an increased risk of your intrauterine infection. So, possible dyan, magkaroon tayo ng chorioamnionitis at saka yung placentitis. Okay? And then postpartum, pwede ding mag-cause yan ng endometritis. So, letter A is the correct answer for your question number 11. Okay, then next after ng ating question number 11, next is your number 12. After a client enters the second stage of labor, Nurse Blessing notes that her amniotic fluid is port wine colored. What does this finding suggest? A. Increased bloody show, B. Normal amniotic fluid, C. Abruptio placenta, or D. Meconium. Okay, anong kulay daw ng lumabas na amniotic fluid? Port wine colored. Pag sinabi natin port wine is red. Okay, so red po ang kulay ng ating port wine. So, reddish stained ang kanyang amniotic fluid. So, anong finding po yan? Anong suggestive natin dyan? So, A, increased bloody show. B, normal amniotic fluid. C, abruption of placenta. O, di meconium. So, eliminated dyan yung ating normal amniotic fluid. Kasi alam naman natin ang normal amniotic fluid color is your straw colored or water colored amniotic fluid. So, it is clear as water with a tiny white specks, which is yun yung ating vernix casiosa, yung ating tiny white specks. Again, ang normal color ng amniotic fluid is clear as water or straw colored amniotic fluid na merong mga tiny white specks, which is the vernix casiosa. So, tanggal dyan yung ating letter B. Then next na i-eliminate natin dito sa ating choices is yung letter D, which is meconium daw yun. Okay, mali po yun kasi kapag meconium stained ang amniotic fluid, it turns into greenish tint. Okay, greenish tint colored ang ating amniotic fluid kapag ito ay meconium stained. And take note, kapag meconium stained ang amniotic fluid sa cephalic presentation baby, that is an indication of your fetal distress. Pero kapag ang presentation ni baby na nakita mo ng greenish tint amniotic fluid is breech presentation, that is normal pa. Okay? So, nagiging abnormal na yung greenish amniotic fluid kapag ito ay cephalic presentation baby. Okay? Sa letter A, mali din po ang ating letter A kasi nga, ang increased bloody show po ay hindi po port wine colored. It is pinkish stained po kapag ito ay bloody show. Hindi po siya port wine. So, the correct answer here is your letter C, abruptio placenta. So, kapag ito ay port wine stained amniotic fluid or reddish stained yung kanyang amniotic fluid, there is a bleeding. Okay? So, pag may pagdurugo, that is a sign of your what? Abruptio placenta or possible placenta previa. Depende po kung anong kulay ng ating dugo. So, we have your port wine stained, possible yan, abruptio placenta. Kapag bright red naman ang lumalabas, possible naman yan na mayroon tayong placenta previa. Pero mas common po dyan yung ating abruptio placenta na nagkukos ng port wine stained amniotic fluid. Again, so the correct answer here is letter C. Ano pa yung possible na pwedeng maging abnormal color yung ating amniotic fluid? So, abnormal din ang amniotic fluid color kapag ang lumalabas na kulay na niya is strong yellow colored or golden yellow colored. Kasi nga, kapag strong yellow colored ang amniotic fluid ni baby, sign po yan na meron tayong hemolytic disease sa bata or sa baby. Okay? Hemolytic disease of the newborn or pwedeng nagkaroon po dyan ng RH incompatibility or yung blood ABO type incompatibility ni nanay at saka ni baby. So, kapag strong yellow colored or golden yellow ang kulay ng amniotic fluid na lumalabas, that is a sign of your incompatibility or your RH incompatibility. And ang other na sakit dyan is yung hemolytic disease of the newborn known as the erythroblastosis fetalis or the hydrops fetalis. And the worst, kapag ang kulay ng amniotic fluid na lumalabas ay tea colored, coffee colored or cola colored or brownish na po siya or dark colored na ang amniotic fluid, that is an indication of your fetal demise. Okay? Fetal demise or fetal demise, patay na yung bata sa loob kapag ito ay dark colored like your tea, coffee or your cola colored amniotic fluid. So again, kapag ganun ang kulay ng amniotic fluid, patay na yung bata sa loob, intrauterine death na po yun or possible intrauterine infection, lalo na kapag merong kakaibang amoy. Okay? Again, so the correct answer here is letter C. It is an abruptio placenta. Then next, for question number 13, Amelia is a 15-year-old high school student visited the health center for her prenatal checkup. Her last menstrual period was October 10, 2020. Based on the nurse's computation utilizing Nagel's rule, the patient's expected date of birth will be on A, September 17, 2021, B, June 17, 2021, C, July 17, 2021, or D, August 17, 2021. So, take note sa ating pag-take ng ating EDC or the EDB, expected date of birth or the expected date of your confinement or delivery, ang ginagamit po natin na rule dito is the Nagel's rule. Tanda niyan, Nagel's rule. So, ang standard na formula ng Nagel's is minus 3 plus 7 plus 1. So, magsusubtract tayo ng 3 sa ating month of LMP, mag-add tayo ng 7 sa day of LMP, and mag-add tayo ng 1 sa year of LMP. So, given in our situation under question number 13, ang LMP ni Amelia is October 10, 2020. So, October is the 10th month in calendar. So, 10-10-2020. So, 10 minus 3 is 7. 10 plus 7 is 17. Then, 2020 plus 1 is 2021. So, 7-17-2021. So, 7-17 is July 17, 2021. Okay? So, kadalasan gagamitin mo yan kapag ang month of LMP ni nanay is nasa April to December. Mag-stick ka sa ating standard na formula ng Nagel's, which is minus 3 plus 7 plus 1. Pero kapag ang month of LMP naman ni nanay, para mas mabilis mo makompute yung ating EDC, ay nasa January to March, pwede mong gamitin yung ating trick method for computation of your EDC na plus 9 plus 7. Add 9 sa ating month, then add 7 sa kanyang days of your LMP. Then sa year, hindi ka na mag-a-add, okay? So, plus 9 plus 7 kapag ang LMP naman ni nanay ay nasa pagitan ng January to March. Example, kapag ang kanyang LMP is January 22, 2020, yan, January 22, 2020, so 1-22, 2020. So, plus 9 plus 7. So, 1 plus 9 is 10, and 22 plus 7 is 29, and 2020 is the same year. So, manganganak po siya ng October 29, 2020. So, October 29, 2020 naman, manganganak itong example natin na merong LMP ng January 22, 2020. So, ganun po yung ating pag-compute ng ating EDC or your EDB by using your LMP, using your Nagel's rule po yan. So, para mas maintindihan nyo po yung ating computation ng ating Nagel's rule at iba pang mga computation methods of obstetrics, ilalagay ko sa aking description dito sa video nito sa baba yung aking link para sa aking video lecture sa ating GPT PAL, Nagel's rule at McDonald's rule at iba pang computation na related sa obstetrics. So after ng video nito, pwede nyong panoorin yun mamaya. So again, so in your question number 13, Amelia na may October 10, 2020 na LMP, ang kanyang EDC ay July 17, 2021. So letter C po ang sagot natin sa ating question number 13, okay? So nakakasabay pa po ba sa ating rationalization sa ating obstetrics? Ayan, okay, very good. So number 13 is letter C, July 17, 2021. Okay, then next, sa ating question number 14. The patient asks you which hormone is essential for maintaining pregnancy. A. Estrogen, B. HCG, C. Oxytocin, or D. Progesterone hormone. Again, so keyword, maintaining pregnancy. So ano po ba yung hormone natin that maintains pregnancy? So take note, the hormone that maintains pregnancy is the progesterone hormone. Bakit? Kasi ang progesterone, it maintains the relaxation of your uterine muscles. So, it relaxes the uterus para ma-maintain po yung ating pregnancy up to term pregnancy. Kasi, sudden drop in the level of your progesterone hormone can cause contraction, okay? So, pwede mag-initiate po yun ng labor contraction under your progesterone deprivation theory of labor. Tandaan nyo po yan. So, letter D is the correct answer here. Yung letter B kasi natin, HCG is the hormone that causes your positive pregnancy test result. So, pwede mo po yan ma-detect via maternal urine and maternal serum. Kapag maternal urine, dapat early voided yan. Early morning voided urine yung ating sample, okay? And detectable na po yan 1 to 2 weeks after ng inyong pregnancy implantation. So, 7 to 10 days, ayan, madedetect mo na yan. So, dapat nasa 10 days after ng implantation, madedetect mo na yung ating HCG sa kanyang urine. Okay? So, that is your HCG causing your positive pregnancy test. Ang estrogen naman sa ating pregnancy period, ang ginagawa naman po niya is to prepare your breast for lactation with your progesterone also and your prolactin hormone. And if we say oxytocin, yan po yung hormone natin for your letdown reflex or the milk ejection reflex kapag tayo na yung magpapa-breastfeeding kay newborn. Okay? So, take note, the hormone that maintains pregnancy is your hormone progesterone. Letter D is the correct answer here. Okay, so next question number 15. What is the correct term for a woman who has completed one pregnancy with a fetus or fetuses reaching the stage of fetal viability? A. Primipara, B. Primigravida, C. Multipara, or D. Noligravida. Okay, so ang tanong po dito is a woman who has completed one pregnancy with a fetus or fetuses reaching the stage of fetal viability. So, pag sinabi po natin fetal viability, take note nurses and midwives that the age of viability is 20 weeks or more, okay? So, kailangan mag-weigh yung baby ng 500 grams to 600 grams or at least 20 weeks or more na po yung kanyang age of viability. So, pag sinabi po natin a woman who's completed a pregnancy with a fetus reaching the stage of viability, that is your primipara. Kasi pag sinabi mong primi, that is one pregnancy that reaches the age of viability. Kasi pag sinabi mong primigravida kasi, that is one pregnancy only. Pero hindi po yan specific ng pinag-usapan yung age of viability ng baby. Kasi sa ating parity, if we say parity, that is the total number of your pregnancy that reaches the age of viability, whether the fetus is dead or alive. So, pwedeng patay or buhay basta umabot po siya ng age of viability that is counted as para. So that is your primi para. So primi para is the correct answer here, okay? Yung primi gravida, that is the first pregnancy. Pag sinabi naman natin kasing noli gravida, noli gravida, noli means no pregnancy, okay? Noli means zero. So hindi pa siya nagbuntis. Or kapag sinabi mo namang noli para naman is never pa siya nag-deliver ng mga babies na umabot ng 20 weeks gestation. So lahat ng mga kanyang pinagbubuntis ay na-abort. So kasi abortion is less than 20 weeks gestation, okay? Tandaan niyo po yan. And kapag sinabi sa board exam na grande multi gravida or grande multi para, yan yung mga nanay na more than 5 na ang pregnancies niya or nakapag-deliver na ng babies more than 5 na naka-abort ng age of viability. Kapag dinugtungan mo ng word na grande or grand multi para or the grand multi gravida. Okay, so yun po yun. Pero pag sinabi mong multigravida lang, that is 2 or more pregnancy. Pag sinabi mo namang multipara, that is 2 or more pregnancy that reaches the age of viability. So dito sa ating question dito, the correct answer here is your primipara. So letter A is the best answer here. Then next, for question number 16, which of the following medications may produce a false negative pregnancy test result? A. Antihypertensive, B. Anticonvulsant, C. Diuretics, or D. Tranquilizers. Okay? So, alin dito yung pwedeng mag-cause ng false negative pregnancy test result? So, A, B, C, or D. So, take note, A, B, and D can cause your false positive pregnancy test result. So, the correct answer in your number 16 is diuretic. So, aside sa ating diuretic, pwede ding mag-cause ng false negative pregnancy test result yung ating promethazine, okay? Promethazine and your diuretic can cause a false negative pregnancy test result. So, yung letter A, antihypertensives, B, anticonvulsant, and tranquilizers can cause false positive pregnancy test result. So, the correct answer here is letter C, diuretic po yung pwedeng mag-cause ng false negative pregnancy test result. So, this is a common board question. Letter C is the correct answer here. And next, for question number 17, in Leopold's first maneuver, the nurse palpates the upper abdomen with both hands to determine the blank of the form that is found. Select all that apply. Number 1, size. Number 2, shape. Number 3, mobility. Or number 4, consistency. So, A, 1 and 2. B, 1, 2, and 4. C, 2 only. Or D, 1, 2, 3, and 4. So, pag sinabi po natin Leopold's maneuver, first maneuver is known as the fundal grip. Okay? So, sa fundal grip, ina-assess po natin dito yung ating consistency of the mass, the size, the shape, and the mobility of the mass. So, malalaman mo dun kung siya by cephalic or bridge presentation. Okay? So, normally, in your fundal grip or your first Leopold's maneuver, dapat ang napapalpate mo sa fundal area ni nanay ay a soft mass, okay? It should be a soft, movable mass, which is the buttocks, okay? Kasi pag malambot ang nakakapa mo sa fundus ni nanay, ibig sabihin yan, puwet po yun ni baby, and yung ulo ni baby yung nasa baba. So, automatic na yung kanyang presentation is cephalic presentation. So, sa ating first Leopold's maneuver, it can be used to assess the fetal presentation and also the age of gestation of the baby. By measuring the fundic height, malalaman mo din kung ano na yung age of gestation ng pregnancy ni nanay by using the landmark of your body. Okay? Tandaan niyan. Sa Bartholomew's rule po yan. So, sa mga hindi pa po nakakapanood ng aking Leopold's maneuver lecture sa aking previous post or video dito sa aking channel, you can visit it at ilalagay ko po ito sa aking description sa baba. Okay? So, panoorin niyo po yan after ng ating rationalization para mas maintindihan niyo po yung ating Leopold's maneuver. Again, so sa Leopold's maneuver, lahat po ay ina-assess natin, the size, the shape, the mobility, and the consistency of the mass. So, all of the above po yan. So, 1, 2, 3, and 4. So, letter D is the correct answer here. Okay? Then next, for question number 18, during the vaginal examination, the nurse palpates the fetal head and a small triangular shaped fontanel. So, the fetal presentation is A, face, B, transverse, C, vertex, or D, brow presentation. Okay? So, yung small triangular shaped fontanel is the posterior fontanel. So, take note, kapag ang posterior fontanel ang nakakapa mo in your internal examination, the baby is in a vertex presentation. Pero kapag ang nakakapa mo naman is the diamond-shaped fontanel, that is in a brow presentation. Again, brow presentation kapag diamond-shaped fontanel ang nakakapa mo, and kapag small triangular-shaped fontanel ang nakakapa mo sa IE, that is a vertex presentation, baby. Kapag face naman, you can palpate the nose or the chin of the baby. And kapag transverse naman yung baby, you can palpate the elbow or the shoulder or the acromial process of the shoulder of the baby. So the correct answer in your question number 18 is letter C, vertex. Keyword niyo dyan yung letter V, parang triangle. Okay, so vertex is the palpation of the triangular shaped fontanelle in your internal examination. So vertex baby po yan, and that is the most ideal fetal presenting part. Okay, that is the most ideal fetal presentation. Okay, so it is a vertex baby. Then next, for question number 19, when questioned, Olivia admitted that she sometimes has several glasses of wine with dinner. Her alcohol consumption puts her fetus at risk for which condition? A. Alcohol addiction, B. Anencephaly, C. Learning disability, or D. Down syndrome. Okay? So, alcohol daw. So, take note, nurses and midwives, na wala pong safe level of alcohol during pregnancy period. So, there is no safe level of alcohol intake during your pregnancy period. So, bawal na bawal po yan in any trimester of your pregnancy. So, maternal alcohol consumption during pregnancy will put her fetus at risk for which condition? So, let's try to eliminate your options first. So, una natin tatanggalin dito yung ating anencephaly. Kasi pag sinabi natin anencephaly, that is a form of neural tube defect. At alam naman po natin na isa sa mga rason ng ating neural tube defect is the lack of your folic acid or vitamin B9 during your pregnancy period, especially on the first trimester of your pregnancy. So, letter B is eliminated. So, next na i-eliminate natin is your letter D, Down syndrome. So, Down syndrome, hindi po yan cause ng alcohol. Kasi ang Down syndrome is chromosomal defect. So, mali din po ang ating letter D. So, between letter A and letter C, ang ating alcohol addiction ay kay nanay at hindi po kay baby. Yung baby ay magkakaroon po ng fetal alcohol syndrome kapag siya ay uminom ng alak during your pregnancy period. And isa sa mga sign ng ating fetal alcohol syndrome is the craniofacial anomaly of the fetus. So, meron po tayo dyang thin upper lip, small chin, so yun po yun, and two close eyes, and the presence of the epicanthal folds in the face of your fetal alcohol baby. And naapektuhan din po yung kanilang cognitive development. So nagkakaroon po dito ng ating learning disability. So the correct answer here is letter C. So naapektuhan po yung baby, nagkakaroon po ng learning disability. So letter C is the correct answer for your question number 19. Okay? Then next, for question number 20, a 15-year-old high school student visited the health center for her prenatal checkup. Per nurse's initial assessment, the patient drinks alcohol and smokes cigarettes about 5 sticks a day for 2 years now. Nurse Elena advised the patient to quit smoking because nicotine will contribute to A. low birth weight infant, B. ectopic tubal pregnancy, C. congenital anomalies, or D. large for gestation age infant. Okay? So, smoking daw po yan. So, remember, nurses and midwives, bawal pong manigarilyo during your period of pregnancy. And kahit hindi ka buntis, bawal pong manigarilyo kasi yung content natin na nicotine is the most addictive substance of your cigarette. And ang ginagawa po ng nicotine ng sigarilyo ay nagkukos po yan ng reduced oxygen binding capacity ng dugo natin. So, malelesen po yung oxygen carrying blood natin. So, malelesen yung ating oxygen sa katawan natin. Okay, tandaan nyo po yan. And take note that nicotine can also constrict blood vessels. So, pag constricted ang blood vessels, at lalong-lalo na kapag buntis ang isang nanay, so limited lang din ang supply ng nutrients and blood papunta kay baby, so hindi makakagrow ng maayos yung fetus mo. So it causes your low birth weight infant in your pregnancy period. So letter A is the correct answer here, okay? Yung letter D kasi natin, large for gestation age infants, that is caused by your diabetic mother. So, DM naman po yan. So, diabetes mellitus in pregnancy, or the GDM naman yung magkukos ng ating large for gestational age infant. Okay, yung congenital anomaly naman, marami pong risk factor dyan. Pwedeng yung mga kinakain ni nanay or mga gamot na iniinom ni nanay during your pregnancy period, or environmental causes po yan. Okay, yung mga pwedeng na nakaahawak siya or naka-ingest po siya ng ating feces of cat causing your toxoplasmosis, nagkaroon siya ng rubella exposure causing your rubella syndrome, or nakapag-take siya ng gamot na nagkos ng phocomelia or amelia baby like your thalidomide in your pregnancy period. Okay? So maraming reason po yan. Again, so kapag nag-smoke ang nanay, pwedeng mag-cause po yan ng low birth weight and a small for gestational age baby. Not only for low birth weight and small for gestational age baby, but also with your stillbirth and premature labor. At marami pa pong iba. Okay? So yun po yung ating tatandaan. So smoking is contraindicated during your pregnancy period. Okay? Kahit hindi si nanay ang naninigarilyo, kahit yung asawa niya, bawal din pong manigarilyo. Okay? Tandaan niyo po yan. Okay? The next question, number 21, when performing breast self-examination, palpation usually starts at the A, upper outer, B, lower outer, C, inner outer, or D, anywhere, okay? So, saan daw mag-start ng palpation kapag ikaw ay magpe-perform ng breast self-examination? So, take note that your breast self-examination is under your secondary level of prevention to screen or to detect any presence of lump into your breast, okay? And the best palpation position is your supine lying position. Lumalabas din po yan sa board exam. So, when palpating your breast, usually it starts at the upper outer quadrant of the breast. So, letter A is the correct answer here, okay? So, always start palpation at the upper outer quadrant of your breast. Again, the best position for your breast self-examination is the supine lying position. Okay, the next, number 22, when is the best time for examination of the breast? A, 3 to 5 days after the onset of menstruation. B, 3 to 5 days before the onset of menstruation. C, 5 to 7 days after the onset of menstruation. Or D, 5 to 7 days before the onset of menstruation. So, the best time for examination of the breast is 5 to 7 days after the onset of your menstruation. So, that is the best time for your breast self-examination, 5 to 7 days after the onset of your menstruation. That is a common board question and that is an NCLEX-based question. So, letter C is the correct answer. The best time is 5 to 7 days after the onset of menstruation. Again, so remember that the best time for examination of the breast is 5 to 7 days after the onset of menstruation or 1 week after your onset of your menstruation. Yun yung time kung saan hindi po affected yung breast mo ng mga hormones at hindi po siya tender or hard. Okay, so letter C is the correct answer here, not letter A. Then next, for question number 23, after assessing the breast of female client, the nurse should explain to the client that most breast tumors occur in the A, upper inner quadrant, B, lower inner quadrant, C, upper outer quadrant, or letter D, lower outer quadrant. Okay? So, alin daw dyan yung pinaka most common site of your breast tumor? Okay? So, take note, nurses and midwives, that the most common site of your breast tumor is at the upper outer quadrant. Okay? So, the upper outer quadrant is the most frequent site for breast tumors kasi this is the most abundant in glandular tissues. So, masyado pong maano dyan, mag-glandular po yung area na yan. So, pinakamalapit sa armpit. So, yan po yung pinaka most common site of your breast tumor cells. Again, so left upper outer quadrant specifically. So, upper outer quadrant is the most common site of your breast tumor cells. Then next, for question number 24, the nurse is caring for a client who has had a right modified radical mastectomy this morning. Which exercise should the nurse encourage the client to perform this evening? Okay, so evening po. So A, hair combing exercises with the right arm. B, wall climbing exercises with the right arm. C, movement of the fingers and wrist of the right arm. Or letter D, exercises of the left arm only. So mag-eliminate muna tayo dito. So take note, nagkaroon po siya ng right modified radical mastectomy. So eliminate natin ang letter D kasi exercises of the left arm only. The word only is obsolete po yan. So mali na po yung word na only. So mali din kapag left arm lang yung i-exercise mo. Dapat ine-exercise mo yung affected na part, yung shoulder ng right arm mo, para magkaroon po tayo dyan ng active range of motion. Okay? So meron po tayong range of motion dito. So letter D is eliminated. So A, B, or C. So lahat po yan ay gagawin ng patient natin. Pero ang gagawin niya the day of the surgery is letter C. Kasi yung letter A at saka letter B, pwede niya po yung gawin later after the day of your surgery. So, pwedeng kinabukasan or the next days. Okay? Pero the day, within the day of your surgery, kasi evening ang tanong dyan, ang pwedeng gawin dito ng patient natin is movement of your fingers and arms of the right arm. Okay? So, yun yung pwede niya munang gawin at the day of your surgery. Then, yung A at saka B, pwede yan sa next day or sa mga susunod na araw. Yan yung gagamitin niya or gagawin niyang regular exercises sa mga susunod na mga araw. Pero the day of the surgery, evening of the surgery, your answer is letter C. Movement of the arms and fingers at the right arm. Okay? So, yun po yung sagot natin. Letter C, and that is an NCLEX-based question. Then next, number 25, which item would the nurse keep at the bedside in case of magnesium sulfate toxicity? A, oxygen. B, calcium gluconate. si naloxone or D-suction equipment. Okay? So, magnesium sulfate toxicity po ang tanong dito. So, usually, sino bang binibigyan natin ng magnesium sulfate drug? Yun yung mga patient na merong eclamptic seizure. Okay? So, yun yung mga pasyenteng may eclampsia. Okay? So, para ma-prevent natin yung ating eclamptic seizure, binibigyan natin yung patient ng magnesium sulfate. So, ngayon, ang tanong dito is, ano daw dapat ang laging nasa bedside ng patient mo? Okay? In case na merong magnesium sulfate toxicity. So, paano ba malalaman na meron siyang magnesium sulfate toxicity? To identify presence of your magnesium sulfate toxicity, nurses and midwives, always remember your burp mnemonics. Check the blood pressure, check the urine output, check the respiratory rate, and check for the patellar reflex, burp mnemonics. So, i-check mo yung BP niya, i-check mo yung urine output niya. Kapag ang urine output niya is less than 30, that is a sign of your magnesium sulfate toxicity. So, less than 30 ml per hour is a sign of your magnesium sulfate toxicity. Ano pa? Letter R, the respiratory rate of the mother. So, if the respiratory rate is less than 12 cycles per minute or breaths per minute, that is also a sign of your magnesium sulfate toxicity. And letter P, the loss or your diminished patellar reflex or the deep tendon reflex, that is a sign of your magnesium sulfate toxicity. And kapag meron po tayong magnesium sulfate toxicity, common antidote or common drug na binibigay natin is your calcium gluconate. 1 gram of your calcium gluconate should be administered slowly. So that is the antidote, and that should be always at the bedside of your patient taking your magnesium sulfate, para in case of your magnesium sulfate toxicity, pwede nating i-counteract yung ating toxicity with your calcium gluconate. Okay? So the correct answer here is your letter B, calcium gluconate po dapat yan. Kasi itong letter C natin, naloxone, that is the Narcan drug. So yung naloxone naman kasi, that is the antidote to counteract toxicity or overdosing of your narcotic drugs or mga opiates drugs natin, like your meperidine or the demerol and your morphine. Okay, tanda yan, lumalabas na po yan sa board exam. So kapag morphine or meperidine yung ating gamot na binigay at nagkaroon ng overdosage or toxicity, ang ibibigay mo naman na gamot is naloxone or Narcan drug. Lumabas din po yan last board exam, pero sa NP3 po yan lumabas. So naloxone po ang sagot natin kapag meperidine toxicity or the narcotic drugs and opiate drugs toxicity. Naloxone po ang ating ibibigay. So pwede rin magbigay ng oxygen tsaka suction equipment, pero hindi po yan yung pinaka dapat na sa bedside natin kapag may binibigay tayong gamot like your magnesium sulfate. It should be your calcium gluconate, because that is the antidote known for your magnesium sulfate toxicity. So letter B is the correct answer here, okay? So ayan, so maraming salamat po ulit sa mga nag-drop at nagbigay ulit ng ating super chat and super stickers. So hindi ko man mabalikan ang inyong mga pangalan ngayon, isa-shoutout ko kayo sa aking mga next event at mga next uploaded videos, okay? So maraming salamat po sa inyong patuloy na suporta sa ating channel. So yun po yun. So sa mga magbibigay pa po ng super chat and super stickers, so send lang po kayo dyan. So click nyo yung ating dollar sign sa ating live chat section. Okay, punta lang po kayo sa live chat section and hanapin po dun sa baba yung ating dollar sign. And pili lang kayo ng super chat and super sticker na inyong ibibigay. So maraming salamat ulit. Especially, shout out ko po yung ating primary supporter lagi, pinaka supporter lagi. Lagi nagbibigay ng super chat, super sticker, si Ma'am Joanna Agawin at yung iba pa. Okay, si Ma'am Joanna Agawin po ay lagi po nagbibigay ng super chat and super stickers yan. Okay, maraming salamat po, Ma'am Joanna Agawin. Okay, so the next question, number 26 na po tayo. The nurse must be alert to magnesium sulfate toxicity. Which of the following is not included? A. Fetal bradycardia. B. Urine output of less than 30 ml per hour. C. Respiration of less than 12 per minute. Or letter D, increase in maternal pulse rate. So sabi ko nga kanina, to identify for the presence of your magnesium sulfate toxicity, you must assess the burp mnemonics. B for blood pressure, U for urine output, R for your respiratory rate, and P for the patellar reflex or the deep tendon reflex. So sign of toxicity kapag na-depress po itong burp na ito. So kapag nagkaroon po tayo ng less than 30 ml of urine per hour and less than 12 breaths per minute sa ating respiratory rate, and the loss or diminished deep tendon reflex or your patellar reflex. Okay? So ang hindi po sign ng ating magnesium sulfate toxicity dito sa ating 26th question is your letter D. Okay? So, hindi po mag-i-increase ang ating maternal pulse rate. Magde-decrease din po dapat yan. Okay? So, magde-decrease din dapat yan at hindi po siya mag-i-increase. Kasi nga, nakaka-depress po yan sa ating katawan, yung ating magnesium sulfate. Again, so letter D is the correct answer here. Again, sign of your magnesium sulfate toxicity, depression of your urine output, respiratory rate, and diminish or loss of your deep tendon reflex or otherwise known as the patella reflex. Pag merong ganyan mga signs, give your calcium gluconate available. Okay, so kailangan ibigay mo na yung ating calcium gluconate, 1 gram slowly. Okay? Then next, for question number 27, after instructing a primary gravid client about how preeclampsia can affect the client and the growing fetus, the nurse realizes that the client needs additional instruction when she says that preeclampsia can lead to which of the following condition? A. Hydrocephalic infant, B. Abruptio placenta, C. Intrauterine growth retardation, or D. Poor placental perfusion. So take note, the client needs additional instruction. So ibig sabihin niyan, negative answer po ang ating hinahanap dito. Ibig sabihin niyan, yung mali na sinabi ni nanay about your preeclampsia. So alin daw dito yung mali na sinabi ni nanay na preeclampsia can lead to? So take note, pag meron pong preeclampsia, okay, yung preeclampsia can lead to eclampsia. And that eclampsia can cause eclamptic seizure, okay? So pag meron po tayong eclamptic seizure, it can also possible cause to abruptio placenta. So it increases the risk of your abruptio placenta, eclamptic seizure. Lumalabas din po yun sa board exam. So after eclamptic seizure, assess the fetal heart tone and assess for the possibility of your abruptio placenta. Ano pang pwede mangyari kapag meron po tayong preeclampsia? Possible din po na yung baby is hindi lalaki ng maayos, okay? So magkakaroon po tayo dito ng growth retardation of the fetus at magiging small for gestational age yung baby kasi nga limited yung ating blood supply or nutrients sa baby, okay? Tandaan niyo po yan. So by means of the increased blood pressure of the mother, yan po magdi-dislodge or magde-detach kay placenta, causing yung abruptio placenta. And kapag may abruptio placenta, limited na rin yung supply papunta kay baby ng nutrients at saka blood. Okay, tandaan niyo po yan. So, nagkakaroon dun ng ating poor placental perfusion and it will lead to intrauterine growth retardation. Okay, so the negative answer here or the client statement that needs additional instruction here is yung sinabi niya na yung preeclampsia daw ay maglilid daw ng hydrocephalic infant. So, letter A is the correct answer here. So, take note, preeclampsia will not lead to hydrocephalic infant. Okay? Preeclampsia can lead to abruptio placenta, intrauterine growth retardation, and poor placental perfusion, but not hydrocephalic infant. So, letter A is the correct answer for question number 27. Okay, then next, question number 28. A woman is a 33 weeks pregnant with preterm rupture of membranes, had blood work ordered daily. Which laboratory report would be most important to read daily? A. Serum creatinine, B. red blood cell count, C. sodium and potassium levels, or D. white blood cell count. Okay? So, ano nangyari kay nanay? Nagkaroon po siya ng preterm rupture of membrane. So, pag merong rupture of membrane, sabi ko nga sa inyo kanina, there is an increased risk of your infection. So, alin dito sa ating blood works ang pwedeng mag-identify kung meron siyang infection? So, A, B, C, or D. So, take note, letter D is the correct answer here. So, white blood cell count po ang pinaka-importante na basahin natin daily. Okay? Kasi nga, rupture of membrane can increase the risk of your intrauterine infection like your metritis, postpartum, and kapag buntis si nanay, pwede mag-cause yan ng chorioamnionitis and placentitis. Letter D is the correct answer here. Then next, for question number 29, upon ultrasound prior to labor, Nurse Mila discovered that Tricia was told about her expected date of confinement that fetus had a breech presentation. So the denominator of the breech presentation is the A. head, B. sacrum, C. feet, or D. shoulder. Okay? So breech presentation's denominator is your sacrum. Kasi nga, puwet po ang unang lumalabas or nauna sa puwerta ni nanay sa kanyang pelvic cavity. So, at the birth canal, sacrum is the presenting part in your breech presentation. Head is the denominator for cephalic baby. Feet is the denominator of your footling baby, while your shoulder is the denominator for your transverse baby or yung ating shoulder presentation BB. So the correct answer here is letter B. Sacrum is the denominator of your bridge presentation, baby. At kapag bridge ang baby, it is delivered via your Mauritius maneuver. So boy is the correct answer here, okay? Then next, for question number 30, coupled with the history of oligohydramnios, Tricia's monitor shows variable decelerations that indicative of your cord compression. The obstetrician has decided to perform amnio infusion via an intrauterine pressure catheter. So Nurse Milan needs to prepare which solution for this procedure? A. Lactated Ringers, B. Dextrose in water, C. Albumin, or D. Fresh frozen plasma. Okay, so ano daw ang nangyari dito? Nagkaroon ng variable deceleration. So take note, meron tayong tatlong klase ng decelerations. We have your early deceleration, variable deceleration, and the late deceleration. So normal lang yung early deceleration. Ang abnormal na deceleration is yung variable at saka yung ating late deceleration. Kapag variable deceleration, that is an indication of your cord compression. Okay, possible na nagkaroon ng cord compression, pwedeng cause ay oligohydramnios or pwedeng cause ay prolapse umbilical cord. Ano pa? Yung late deceleration naman, abnormal din po yun kasi that is a sign of your uteroplacental insufficiency. So, konti na lang yung dugo or oxygen na dumadaloy kay baby kaya nagkaroon ng late deceleration. Ngayon, ang sinabi dito is magpe-perform daw ng amnio infusion. So, what is amnio infusion? So, pag sinabi po nating amnio infusion, that is the replacement of your amniotic fluid, okay, via your catheter. Okay, so intrauterine catheter. So, replacement of amniotic fluid to relieve your cord compression caused by your oligohydramnios para ma-reverse natin yung ating variable deceleration. So, amnio infusion usually uses your warm normal saline solution or pinaka-common na ginagamit dyan is the warm lactated Ringer's solution. Not your albumin and not your dextrose in water. So the correct answer here is letter A. Lactated Ringer's po ang ginagamit natin in your amnio infusion procedure. Okay? So letter A is the correct answer for question number 30. Then next, for question number 31, prior to amnio infusion, why is it important for the solution to be kept warm to body temperature? A. To prevent chilling of the woman and the fetus, B. To prevent supine hypotension, C. To prevent cold stress, or D. All of the above. So ano pong sagot natin dyan? So bakit kailangan daw na i-warm natin or dapat warm daw yung ating solution, yung ating lactated Ringer solution bago natin ilagay sa ating amniotic cavity? So we have your amnio infusion. So A, B, C, or D. So take note, in your question number 31, the correct answer here is letter A, to prevent chilling of the woman and the fetus. So take note, kailangan makip natin yung ating solution into warm to body temperature to prevent chilling of the woman and the fetus. That is the number one reason kung bakit kailangan natin i-warm yung ating solution, which is the lactated Ringer solution, into a body temperature. So letter A, to prevent chilling of the woman and the fetus. That is the correct answer, okay? So next, number 32, Pili enters the labor and delivery unit in probable preterm labor at 36 weeks. So betamethasone is prescribed to be administered and the patient asks nurse about the purpose of this medication. So betamethasone or celestone. So corticosteroid drug po yan for preterm labor. So A, promote fetal lung maturity, B, prevent the premature closure of the ductus arteriosus, C, delay delivery of the delay delivery at least 48 hours, or D, stop the premature uterine contraction. Okay? So take note that the primary purpose of your betamethasone or celestone in your preterm labor is to promote fetal lung maturity, and that is always in the board exam. So common board po yan. So letter A is the correct answer. So betamethasone will promote fetal lung maturity. Okay? So para ma-lung matured po siya with your LS ratio of 2:1. Pero pag paglabas ni baby na premature, na hindi pa rin mature yung lungs niya, pwede po tayong magbigay ng surfactants via endotracheal route. And that surfactant will help the baby to prevent what? To prevent your respiratory distress syndrome or yung tatawag natin na hyaline membrane disease. Okay? So next, number 33, the postpartum nurse is providing instruction to a client after delivery of a healthy newborn. Which time frame should the nurse relay to the client regarding the return of bowel function? A, 3 days postpartum, B, 7 days postpartum, C, on the day of delivery, or D, within 2 weeks postpartum. So take note, ang tinatanong po dito is kung kailan babalik yung normal bowel pattern ni nanay. So normal bowel pattern will return
2 to 3 days after your delivery.
So the correct answer here in your question number 33 is letter A, 3 days postpartum po yan. Okay, so letter A is the correct answer for your return of your bowel function. Again, bumabalik din po yan 3 days postpartum. And dapat suggest the nanay na kumain po siya ng high fiber diet after your delivery kasi baka may punit po siya or mga lacerations, mahirap po siyang magpupo pag meron siyang mga lacerations. So, letter A, 3 days postpartum, that is the return of your bowel function. Then next, for question number 34, the nurse is monitoring client in the immediate postpartum period for signs of hemorrhage. So, which sign, if noted, would be an early sign of an excessive blood loss? A, temperature of 100.4 degree Fahrenheit. B, an increase in the pulse rate from 88 to 102 beats per minute. C, a blood pressure change from 130 over 88 to 124 over 80 millimeters mercury. Or letter D, an increase in the respiratory rate from 18 to 22 breaths per minute. So, alin daw dito yung sign na meron po tayong excessive blood loss? Ang tanong po is early sign, okay? Early sign of excessive blood loss. So, in your choices, the correct answer here is letter B, an increase in the pulse rate from 88 to 102 beats per minute. Why? Kasi palatandaan po yan na nagko-compensate po yung puso ni nanay para mag-pump siya ng mag-pump ng blood para masuplayan po niya yung mga vital organs ng katawan ni nanay. So, ibig sabihin yan, not enough yung blood volume niya kaya nagpa-pump siya ng mabilis para mag-compensate po siya at masuplayan niya yung mga vital organs ni nanay. So, letter B is an indication of your early sign of your excessive blood loss or tinatawag natin na postpartum hemorrhage, okay? So, letter B is the correct answer for question number 34. The next, for question number 35, the nurse is providing instructions about measures to prevent postpartum mastitis to a client who is breastfeeding her newborn. Which client statement would indicate a need for further instruction? Again, so A, I should breastfeed every 2 to 3 hours. B, I should change the breast pads frequently. C, I should wash my hands well before breastfeeding. Or D, I should wash my nipples daily with soap and water. Okay, so take note, ang tanong po dito is indicates a need for further instructions. So, ibig sabihin niyan, kung kailangan niya ng further instruction, ibig sabihin mali ang ginagawa ni nanay in the care of the breast in case of your postpartum mastitis. So, alin dito ang mali na hindi pwedeng gawin para ma-prevent ang ating postpartum mastitis? So, tamang letter A, kailangan mo mag-breastfeed every 2 to 3 hours para ma-prevent natin yung milk stasis na pwedeng mag-cause ng ating breast mastitis, okay? So, letter B, I should change the breast pads frequently. Tama din po yan. So, para hindi po siya mag-moist at mag-cause ng sore crack nipples, causing also your entry of your microorganism, Staphylococcus aureus, causing your postpartum mastitis. So, tamang A, tamang B. So, between letter C and letter D, ang mali po dito na nasabi ni nanay yung paggamit niya ng sabon to care the breast. So, bawal po ang paggamit ng soap sa inyong breast. So, soap can cause dryness into your breast, causing your sore crack nipples, and that sore crack nipples can be the entry point of your microorganism like your Staphylococcus aureus, causing your postpartum mastitis. So, ang pagkakaiba po ng engorgement kay mastitis ay ang engorgement pwede mangyari yan within the first week after delivery. So, a few days after delivery, pwede magkaroon ng engorgement. At pag sinabi naman natin mastitis, weeks after delivery po yan nangyayari, okay? So, weeks after delivery po yan nangyayari. Again, so bawal gumamit ng soap sa inyong breast kasi nakakadry po yan ng inyong nipples or sa inyong breast skin. So, letter D is the correct answer for your question number 35. Okay? So, letter D is the correct answer here. Okay? So, tandaan nyo po yan, ang breast mastitis, possible sign dyan, redness, warmth, and tender and swollen po yung breast mo. Okay? So, yun po yun. Then, next question number 36. A client in postpartum unit complains of sudden sharp chest pain and dyspnea. The nurse notes that the client is tachycardic and the respiratory rate is elevated. The nurse suspects a pulmonary embolism. So, which should be the initial nursing action? A. Initiates an intravenous line. B. Assess the client's blood pressure. C. Prepare to administer morphine sulfate. Or letter D. Administer oxygen 8 to 10 liters per minute by face mask. Okay. So, alin daw po dito yung ating pinaka-initial nursing action. So, take note, our initial nursing action in case of your pulmonary embolism, postpartum mother here, na meron po siyang sharp chest pain and dyspnea is to administer your oxygen 8 to 10 liters per minute by face mask. Okay? So, the correct answer here is letter D. So, pwede din natin isagot kapag meron dyan yung positioning. Kasi right after na meron kang nakitang signs and symptoms of your pulmonary embolism, you can also reposition the mother immediately. Place the patient in the left lateral decubitus position or tinatawag natin na Durant maneuver and Trendelenburg position. So again, tandaan natin, pwede rin natin i-position yung patient na mayroong pulmonary embolism to left side lying position or decubitus position with slight Trendelenburg position. This is to prevent the air from traveling through the right side of the heart into the pulmonary artery leading to right ventricular outflow obstruction. So, yun po yun. So, pag walang positioning, choose your oxygen. Tanda niya, choose your oxygen by mask. And that is letter D in our question. So, the correct answer is letter D. Okay, the next question, number 37. The nurse is providing instructions to a client who has been diagnosed with mastitis. Which statement, if made by the client, indicates a need for further instruction? So, need for further instruction, ibig sabihin negative na naman po yung sagot nating hahanapin. Negative statement made by the client. So, A, I need to wear a supportive bra to relieve the discomfort. B, I need to stop breastfeeding until this condition resolves. C, I can use analgesic to assist in alleviating some of the discomfort. Or letter D, I need to take antibiotics and I should begin to feel better in 24 to 48 hours. Okay. So, alin daw dito yung negative statement na sinabi ni nanay that needs further instruction? So, yung letter A, tama po na gumamit siya ng supportive bra para hindi po, para makompress yung breast niya. Okay. Yung letter C naman, I can use analgesic to assist in alleviating some of the discomfort. Tama din po yun kasi nga, analgesic is a pain reliever. So, pwede po siyang mag-take ng pain reliever dito. Sa letter D naman natin, I need to take antibiotics. Yes, kasi kapag ang kanyang mastitis is the infectious type na mastitis caused by the Staphylococcus aureus, usually nagre-reseta po yung doktor dyan ng ating antibiotic, especially yung cloxacillin antibiotic. So, the correct answer here is letter B. Okay, so stop daw niya yung breastfeeding. So, mali po. So, no matter na meron kang engorgement or mastitis, continue your breastfeeding para maiwasan po natin yung milk stasis. At yung milk stasis na yun, yun yung magfa-further na magkukos ng ating inflammation of the breast. Okay? So, dapat continue breastfeeding kapag meron kang engorgement or mastitis. And ano pang gagawin mo kapag meron kang mastitis? Dapat mag-cold compress ka din before and after breastfeeding. Okay? Then, isa din sa pinaka-importante kapag merong mastitis at para maiwasan ng mastitis is the maternal hygiene. So, kailangan maghugas ng kamay si nanay bago magpa-breastfeeding. And ensure your proper attachment of the baby into your breast para ma-prevent natin yung injury sa nipples mo or sa areola mo, causing your sore crack nipples na pwede maging entry point ng microorganism na magkukos ng ating mastitis infection. Again, so yun po yung ating gagawin. Dapat continue breastfeeding. Dapat magpa-feed ka pa rin ng every 2 to 4 hours in a day and every 4 to 6 hours at night naman. And dapat makapagpa-breastfeeding ka 10 to 12 times every 24 hours. Or every day, dapat nakakapag-breastfeed ka pa rin ng 10 to 12 times in a day. So, yun po yung ating breastfeeding during your mastitis and your engorgement condition. Okay? Then next, for question number 38, the rubella vaccine has been prescribed for a new mother. So, which statement should the nurse make when providing information about the vaccine to the client? A. You should avoid sexual intercourse for 2 weeks after administration of the vaccine. B. You should not become pregnant for 2 to 3 months after administration of the vaccine. C. You should avoid heat and extreme temperature changes for 1 week after administration of the vaccine. Or letter D, you must sign an informed consent because anaphylactic reactions can occur with the administration of the vaccine. So, among which of the following options dito ang ating pwedeng i-provide the information sa mga nanay na nagre-receive ng rubella vaccine? So, unahin natin yung mga negative na mga sagot dito. So, tanggalin una natin yung letter A, okay? Yung letter A, avoid mo daw ng sexual intercourse for 2 weeks after the administration of the vaccine. So, take note, hindi porket nag-receive ka ng rubella vaccine ay hindi na rin pwede makipag-sexual intercourse sa asawa mo. So, pwede pa rin makipag-contact sa inyong asawa kapag nag-receive kayo ng rubella vaccine, basta mag-safe sex kayo, gumamit ng condom, or mag-take ka ng contraceptive pills para hindi ka mabuntis. Okay? So, tanda nyo yan, para hindi ka mabuntis. So, take note kasi kapag mag-take ka ng rubella vaccine or magre-receive ka ng rubella vaccine, dapat iwasan mong mabuntis within the period of 3 months. Okay? 3 months after your receiving of your vaccine. Kasi nga, bawal kang mag-receive ng vaccine kapag buntis ka. And bawal ka ding mabuntis kapag nag-receive ka ng rubella vaccine. Kasi ang rubella vaccine ay isang live attenuated vaccine. So, live attenuated virus po yung ating rubella vaccine. So, the vaccine could cross the placenta and may result in a viral infection of the fetus. Pwede po yung mag-cause ng congenital rubella syndrome. So, kapag buntis ka or nabuntis ka na meron kang na-receive na rubella vaccine, pwede mag-cause yan ng miscarriage or spontaneous abortion. Ano pa? Stillbirths at saka birth defect kay baby. So, ang mga common na birth defect dito ay tinatawag natin na congenital rubella syndrome or the CRS. Okay? Congenital rubella syndrome, example, is the patent ductus arteriosus. Ano pa? We have also your pulmonary artery stenosis. Yung patent ductus arteriosus at saka pulmonary artery stenosis, that is a form of your congenital heart defect caused by your rubella exposure during the first trimester of your pregnancy. So bukod sa ating congenital heart defects caused by your rubella, pwede ding magkaroon dito ng eye disorders or problema sa mata si baby. So it can also lead to cataract, to glaucoma and microphthalmia or yung maliit yung kanyang mata. And pwede rin magkaroon siya dito ng sensory neural hearing loss. So sensory neural hearing loss or sensory neural deafness si baby. So paglabas ni baby, hindi po siya nakakarinig or deaf po si baby. Bingi yung baby kapag siya na-expose sa ating rubella virus. Again, so kapag magre-receive ka ng rubella, kailangan iwasan mo mabuntis 2 to 3 months after receiving your injection. So in this question, the correct answer here is letter B, avoid pregnancy 2 to 3 months after your rubella shot. Okay? So B is the correct answer here. Okay, the next question, number 39, the nurse prepares a plan of care for the client with pre-eclampsia and documents that if the client progresses from pre-eclampsia to eclampsia, the nurse should take which first action? So first action po ang tinatanong dito sa ating question number 39. So A, administer oxygen by face mask. B, clear and maintain an open airway. C, administer magnesium sulfate intravenously. Or letter D, assess the blood pressure and the fetal heart rate. Okay, so take note, ano daw yung una mong gagawin kapag nag-lead yung ating pre-eclampsia to eclampsia. So pag sinabi po natin eclampsia, ang difference po ng ating eclampsia ating sa ating pre-eclampsia is the presence of your convulsive seizure, okay? So, parehas po sila ng mga signs, pero meron pong convulsive seizure kay eclampsia. So, pag merong convulsive seizure, one of your first action as a nurse or as a midwife is to clear and maintain an open airway. Tandaan nyo po yan. So, A, B, C po ang ating prioritization dito. So, airway first, bago yung breathing then circulation, okay? So, airway, saan ba yung airway dyan? So, letter B is the correct answer kasi clear and maintain an open airway daw. So, take note kapag mag-answer po tayo ng mga prioritization ng mga tanong, mga first action na yan, pag maglaban-laban yung ABC natin, unahin natin yung airway bago yung magbigay ng oxygen. So, open the airway first before giving your oxygen kasi useless ang oxygen kapag hindi open yung airway kasi hindi rin siya makakapasok. So, kailangan i-clear muna natin and maintain an open airway bago yung ating mga ibang choices. Okay, so pwede mong gawin yung ibang choices pero ang pinaka first action natin dyan is to clear and maintain an open airway. So bukod sa ating airway, breathing and circulation, always ensure also the safety of your patient. So apply nating per orem kapag nagkakaroon po siya ng convulsive seizure, bawal maglagay ng padded tongue depressors na mga kutsara, tinidor sa kanyang bibig. So bawal din i-restraint at bawal din nating i-transfer yung ating mother kapag siya ay nagko-convulsive seizure. Kapag nag-seizure po siya sa bed niya, kailangan itaas natin yung side rails with pads. Okay? So padded side rails must be up and lower the bed in its possible lowest position para kapag nahulog si nanay, hindi gaano kataasan yung kanyang ikakabagsak. And kapag ano naman po, nagsiseizure si nanay sa baba or sa floor, kailangan i-protect natin si nanay against your mga things na nakasurround po sa kanya. So, clear the things or clear the surrounding of the mother and protect the head against injury. Tandaan nyo po yan. Then, after ng seizure natin, doon mo na i-monitor ang kanyang blood pressure at saka fetal heart tone kasi possible na after ng ating convulsive seizure in eclampsia, magkakaroon ng abruptio placenta and pwedeng mag-cause ng fetal distress kay fetus. So, assess the fetal heart tone and assess for the possibility of your abruptio placenta after your convulsive seizure. Then, inject your magnesium sulfate to prevent future episodes of your convulsive seizure. Pero, bawal ka pong mag-inject ng magnesium sulfate during your convulsive seizure. Okay? So, tandaan nyo po yan. We have your open the airway first before giving your oxygen and before administration of your magnesium sulfate. Mauuna po dyan yung clearing and maintaining an open airway. So, letter B is the correct answer for your question number 39. Ayan po. Okay, so number 39 po, letter B. Then next natin na question is number 40 na. So medyo nakakarami-rami na po tayo ng ating nararasyo. So let's proceed to our question number 40. Then ayan, so maraming salamat na naman po sa mga nagbigay ng ating super chat and super sticker. So hindi ko man po kayo mabanggit sa ngayon. I-shoutout ko na lang po kayo sa ating mga next event. Okay? So naka-share screen po ako ngayon sa ating rationalization, kaya hindi ko po nakikita yung mga comments. Okay? So we have your number 39. So first action daw is clear and maintain an open airway. So maraming salamat po sa mga nagbibigay suporta sa ating mga live at saka mga premiere videos or mga live and mga premiere events dito sa ating YouTube channel. So I hope na meron po kayo natututunan, and I hope na kailangan i-note nyo din po yan sa mga inyong mga notebook at mga review notes para in the future magamit nyo po yan sa inyong board preparation. So i-take note nyo lamang po lahat na aking masinasabi, kasi ito po yung mga common board question at saka mga common board concept. Okay? Maraming salamat sa mga nagsusupport at nagbibigay ng ating super chat at saka super stickers during our live and premieres dito sa ating YouTube channel. Again, so next question na po tayo is question number 40. The nurse is caring for a client who is receiving oxytocin or pitocin for induction of labor and notes a non-reassuring fetal heart rate pattern on the fetal monitor. So on the basis of this finding, the nurse should take which action first? A. Stop the oxytocin infusion. B. Check the client's blood pressure. C. Check the client for bladder distension. Or D. Place the client inside lying position. So ano daw ang una mong gagawin kapag meron kang nakitang non-reassuring fetal heart tone? So ibig sabihin niya, nagkakaroon po siya ng mga late decelerations dito. So pag meron mga late decelerations dito, that is a sign of your utero-placental insufficiency. So anong una mong gagawin kapag ganun? So A, B, C, or D. So take note, naka-oxytocin po yung ating patient. So A, B, C, or D. Anong una mong gagawin dito? So pag ganitong meron po tayo nakikita mga non-reassuring fetal heart rate sa ating fetal monitor, ang una mong gagawin kapag naka-oxytocin yung nanay is to stop the oxytocin. Tanda niyan. So stop the oxytocin first, then side lying position para ma-increase yung ating perfusion papunta kay baby. Then kapag meron pong oxygen by mask, dapat bigyan natin ng oxygen 8 to 10 liters per mask and notify the healthcare provider or the physician. So tandaan niyo po yung pagkakasunod-sunod natin. First is to stop your oxytocin infusion, then next left side lying position, again left po, left side lying position, then oxygen of 8 to 10 liters per minute per mask or by mask, and we have your notify the provider or the physician. So yun po yung pagkakasunod-sunod kapag meron po tayong nakita mga late decelerations or mga non-reassuring fetal heart tone sa ating fetal monitor. So stop the oxytocin infusion first. Pero pag walang oxytocin na nare-receive si nanay, ang una mong gagawin is left side lying position. Keyword, late deceleration, L for L. Late deceleration is for left side lying position. That is for your late deceleration, the non-reassuring fetal heart tone into your monitor or fetal monitor. So the correct answer here is letter A. Stop your oxytocin infusion first. Okay, then next question number 41. The nurse receives an order to start an infusion for a client who's hemorrhaging due to placenta previa. What supplies will be needed? A. Y tubing, normal saline solution, and 20 gauge catheter. B. Y tubing, lactated Ringer solution, and 18 gauge catheter. C. Y tubing, normal saline, 18 gauge catheter. Or letter D. Y tubing, lactated Ringers, and 20 gauge catheter. Okay. So alin daw dito yung supply na kailangan mo kapag mag-infuse tayo ng dugo or blood transfusion? So A, B, C, or D. So take note, kapag meron po tayong blood transfusion order sa ating physician, kailangan po natin ng mga Y tubing. Okay? So Y tubing ang ating kailangan dito. So kailangan ng Y tubing. So pasok lahat ng mga choices na may Y tubing. Then next, ano yung pinaka most compatible na IV solution for your blood products for blood transfusion? So take note that normal saline or 0.9 NaCl po ang pinaka most compatible and most ideal solution for your blood transfusion. So tanggal na dito yung mga lactated Ringer. So tanggal yung B, tanggal yung D. So A or C na lang ang ating natitirang choices dito. So between 20 gauge at saka 18 gauge of your catheter or your needle, anong mas kailangan natin kapag blood products ang ating pinibigay? So take note, lumabas din po yan last board exam, yung gauge ng needle kapag magbibigay po tayo ng blood products. Okay? So take note that the smallest gauge of needle for your blood transfusion is 18 gauge. Okay? So ngayon, sa blood transfusion, kailangan natin dito ng Y tubing, normal saline, and your 18 gauge catheter or 18 gauge needle. So the correct answer here is letter C. So for question number 41, you need your supplies na Y tubing, normal saline, at saka 18 gauge catheter or 18 gauge needle. So letter C is the correct answer here. Then next, for question number 42, a woman in labor is at risk for abruptio placenta. Which of the following assessment would most convince you and the pregnant woman to believe that this has happened? A. Painless vaginal bleeding and downward trend of BP. B. An increased blood pressure and scanty urination. C. Pain at the lower quadrant and increased pulse rate. Or letter D. A sharp fundal pain and discomfort between contractions. Okay, so ang tinatanong po dito is abruptio placenta. So eliminate muna natin ang ating letter C, kasi kapag sinabi nating pain at the lower quadrant and increase in pulse rate, that is a possible sign of ectopic pregnancy. Kasi ang ectopic pregnancy, yan po yung ating mga pain at the lower quadrant of your abdomen. So possible left or right po yan, and with radiation to the shoulder, and increases your pulse rate. So that is a sign of your ectopic pregnancy. So next na tatanggalin natin ay letter A, painless vaginal bleeding is not a sign of abruptio placenta. Because in abruptio placenta, there is a pain, okay? So painful po ang inyong abdomen kapag ikaw ay may abruptio placenta. So pag painless, that is more on your placenta previa. So between letter B and between letter D, the correct answer here is letter D, okay? It is a sharp fundal pain during your contractions or between contractions. Kasi take note, sa abruptio placenta kasi, the most hallmark sign or the hallmark sign of your abruptio placenta is the presence of your painful or tender abdomen. Okay? So painful, tender abdomen is a sign of your abruptio placenta. So kahit hindi mo po makitaan ng dugo yung ating abruptio placenta, kapag meron po tayong painful, bored and rigid or hard abdomen, that is a classic sign of your abruptio placenta. Kasi karamihan ng mga kaso ng ating abruptio placenta is concealed type, okay? So pag sinabi natin concealed type, yung bleeding hindi mo makikita, so it is a covert bleeding. So covert type po yung ating abruptio placenta. Usually yung dugo na iipon po sa likod mismo ng placenta kung saan na-detach po yung ating placenta sa abruptio placenta. Again, so the correct answer here is letter D, a sharp fundal pain during or between your uterine contractions, okay? Okay, so para mas maintindihan po natin ang ating differences ng ating placenta previa kay abruptio placenta, let's talk about the differences between the two condition, okay? So, let's talk about first the placental implantation. So, sa placenta previa, ang placenta po is abnormally implanted. Tanda niyan. So, placenta previa is abnormal implantation of the placenta at the lower portion of the uterus, usually near the cervix or near the isthmus of the uterus. While on your abruptio placenta, the placenta is normally implanted. So, ang problema lang kasi natin sa ating abruptio placenta is the sudden premature or your premature detachment or separation of the placenta into your fundal portion, okay? Or into the uterus. Again, so kapag meron tayong premature separation or premature detachment of your placenta, that is the abruptio placenta. But the placenta is normally implanted at the fundal portion of the uterus. While in your placenta previa, the abnormal implantation of placenta happens at the lower portion of the uterus. Again, abnormal implantation, placenta previa. Normal implantation, abruptio placenta. Ang problema lang kay abruptio placenta, merong premature separation or detachment na naganap. Okay? Then next, let's talk about the uterus, okay? The uterus of your placenta previa is soft and non-tender. Malambot po ang tiyan ni nanay kapag ipapalpate mo sa placenta previa. Wala po diyang tenderness, okay? Soft and non-tender uterus, that is a sign of your placenta previa. While in your abruptio placenta, the uterus or the abdomen of the mother here is hard, board-like, rigid, and tender, okay? So hard, board-like, rigid, and tender uterus is a classic sign of your abruptio placenta. And for your uterine contraction, take note that in your placenta previa, wala pong contraction na nagaganap. So no contraction, kaya nga soft and non-tender yung uterus. But in your abruptio placenta, meron po ditong periods of uterine contraction. So with contractions, kaya tumitigas yung tiyan ni nanay. So meron tayong hard, board-like, and rigid, and tender abdomen. So with contraction po kasi ang abruptio placenta. And kapag sinabi naman natin bleeding or yung pagdurugo sa ating abruptio placenta and placenta previa, sa placenta previa, that is bright red bleeding. Okay? Bright red kasi nga external yung bleeding. So nakakalabas agad yung dugo. Sa abruptio placenta naman, dark red po yung ating bleeding kasi nga concealed type po ang ating bleeding dito. Yung dugo kasi naiipon muna sa likod ng placenta bago lumabas. Kaya lumabas, dark red bleeding na. And for your pain, take note that the classic or the hallmark difference of your placenta pre-ven abruptio placenta is the presence and absence of pain. Kapag may pain, that is abruptio placenta. Pag walang pain, that is placenta previa. Tandaan yan. So, not the color of the bleeding, not the presence of contraction, and not the uterine consistency ang ating gagamitin na pang-difference, pang-differentiate ng ating placenta previa at saka abruptio placenta. Use the presence and absence of pain. Pag may pain or painful yung kanyang abdomen, abruptio placenta po yan. Kapag wala pong pain or painless ang kanyang abdomen, that is the placenta previa. So, the presence and absence of pain can differentiate placenta previa and abruptio placenta. So, pag walang pain, placenta previa. Pag may pain, that is abruptio placenta. Again, so these are the differences of your placenta previa and abruptio placenta. So, i-take note nyo po yan para mas madali nyo po siyang maunawaan at matandaan para pagdating ng board exam, anuman ang lumabas sa dalawang yan, placenta previa man or abruptio placenta man ang lumabas sa board exam, alam nyo na kung ano yung pagkakaiba ng placenta previa at saka abruptio placenta. Then next for question number 43, so when Sandy was held for ambulation for the first time, she mentioned that she had heavy local discharge. So which of the following assessment finding would best help the nurse decide that the flow is within the normal limit? So ang tanong dito is kung alin daw dito yung normal limit ng local discharge, okay? So A, her flow is over 500 ml. B, the color of the flow is red. C, her uterus is soft to your touch. Or letter D, the flow contains large clots. Okay? So, tanggalin muna natin dito yung mga abnormal na mga findings sa ating local discharge. So, letter A is obviously wrong answer kasi nga, kapag ang flow mo is more than 500 ml, that is categorized as hemorrhage. Tandaan yan. So, that is a heavy bleeding kapag ito ay more than 500 ml. Kasi, take note that the criteria of the WHO for your postpartum bleeding is more than 500 ml of your postpartum bleeding or postpartum discharge. So, mali po ang ating letter A kasi it represents your postpartum hemorrhage. More than 500 ml is postpartum hemorrhage. So, hindi po yan normal. Okay? So, mali po ang ating letter A. Then next na i-eliminate natin dito is your letter C, her uterus is soft to your touch. So a uterus which is soft to your touch is a sign of your uterine atony. And soft boggy uterus is the classic sign of your uterine atony or your relaxed uterus. At kapag relaxed po ang uterus, kapag hindi po siya nagko-contract postpartum, naglilid po yan sa ating postpartum hemorrhage. Early postpartum hemorrhage po ang pwedeng mangyari kapag meron kang uterine atony. So, abnormal din po ang ating letter C. So, pag ganyan, kapag sa letter C naman, imamassage mo yung fundus kapag soft yung uterus ni nanay. And next na i-eliminate natin dito is your letter D, the flow contains large clots. Okay? So, mali din po kapag ang local discharge mo is meron po siyang clots or blood clots. So, abnormal din po kapag merong blood clots ang local discharge mo. So, mali din yung ating letter D. Okay? So, the correct answer in your question number 43 is letter B, the color of the flow is red. Kasi nga, take note that the first type of your local discharge to appear is the lochia rubra, which is present within the first 1 to 3 days after your delivery. Eh, sabi dito sa ating situation is, si Sandy daw is first time niyang mag-ambulate. And take note, after 6 hours of your labor, pwede na bang mag-ambulate yung nanay na nanganak para ma-improve po yung kanyang circulation at ma-prevent po natin yung mga blood clots or complications of your prolonged immobility. Okay? So, the correct answer here is letter B. The color of the flow is red kasi nga ang kanyang local discharge pa dyan is the lochia rubra. Okay? And that is color red lochia. Letter B is the correct answer for your question number 43. Okay? Then next, we have your question number 44. So, Nurse Adele completed the vaginal examination on the patient. She recorded 75%, 7 cm, and 0. So, which of the following is a correct interpretation of the data? A. Effacement is 5 cm completed. B. Fetal presenting part is engaged. C. Dilatation is 75% is completed. Or letter D. Acceleration phase of the first stage is about to begin. Okay, so alin daw dito yung correct interpretation of your data? So, 75%, 7 cm, and 0. Okay, so interpret natin yung data na sa ating situation. 75%, kapag meron ka nakitang percentage doon sa ating obstetrics data, that is the effacement of the cervix. So, ibig sabihin po niyan, effacement of your cervix is 75% completed. So, mali yung ating letter C. Kasi sabi dyan, dilatation daw yung 75%. Mali po yun, okay? So, baliktad po sila ng ating letter A. Sabi sa letter A, effacement is 5 cm daw. So, mali din. Kasi nga, ang kanyang cervical dilatation is 7 cm. At saka yung kanyang effacement is 75%. So, mali ang ating letter A din. So, between letter B and your letter D, the correct answer here is letter B. Fetal presenting part is engaged. Paano mo nasabing engaged na po yan? Because of your station 0, okay? So, in your fetal station, we have your negative and the positive station. Kapag negative station, nasa ataas po yan. So, above the ischial spine po kapag negative station po yan. And kapag positive station naman, that is below the ischial spine. At ibig sabihin yan, malapit nang ma-deliver si baby. Pero kapag ang station sa ating fetal station is 0, 0 is at the level of the ischial spine. And it is considered that the fetal biparietal or the largest diameter of the fetal head is engaged already at the pelvic brim. So, the correct answer for your question number 44 is letter B, fetal presenting part is engaged. Okay? Then next, for question number 45, a woman has been rushed to the hospital with ruptured membrane. So, which of the following should the nurse check first? A. Check for the presence of infection. B. Assess for prolapse of the umbilical cord. C. Check the maternal heart rate. Or D. Assess the color of your amniotic fluid. So, remember nurses and midwives, sabi ko kanina, kapag meron po tayong ruptured membrane, may possibility po na mangyari yung ating cord prolapse at saka yung ating cord compression. So, alin daw dito yung una mong i-check as a nurse or as a midwife? So, check first for the presence of your prolapse umbilical cord or the cord prolapse. Bakit? Kasi nga, possible po kasi na ma-dislodge yung kanyang umbilical cord palabas sa kanyang vaginal introitus kapag meron po tayong sudden rupture of membrane. So, letter B is the correct answer here. Yung letter A kasi natin, check for the presence of infection. Pwede pong mag-occur ang infection after 24 hours na meron tayong prolonged ruptured membrane. Okay? Yung letter C, check the maternal heart rate. So, take note, hindi po related yung ating blood volume sa pag-rupture ni amniotic fluid. So, hindi po siya related sa blood volume ni nanay. So, hindi magko-compensate yung puso niya kasi hindi naman babagsak yung blood volume ni nanay para bumilis ang kanyang pulse rate. So, mali din ang ating letter C. So, the correct answer here is to check for the presence of your prolapse umbilical cord. So, letter B is the correct answer here. Okay? And always remember, nurses and midwives, na kapag meron kang nakitang prolapse umbilical cord, ang una mong gagawin is to reposition the mother, okay? Reposition the mother into a modified Trendelenburg position or slight Trendelenburg position. Pag wala po tayong slight Trendelenburg position, we have your knee chest position also to relieve your compression to your umbilical cord. Then next, anong gagawin mo? Next is kapag meron kang nakitang protruding umbilical cord or funis doon sa kanyang vaginal introitus, get a sterile gauze or yung OS natin, kunin mo yung ating sterile OS or gauze, then basain mo siya ng normal saline solution and ilagay mo sa ating protruding umbilical cord. That is to prevent dryness of the cord, causing your cord compression and causing your fetal distress to the newborn. And take note, never ever push back the cord back into the vagina. Pero pwede mong medyo i-lift up mo or i-push back yung ating presenting part or i-lift mo pataas yung presenting part to relieve your cord compression. Ang pwede mo lang medyo itaas or i-push na nga kaunti is yung presenting part para ma-relieve natin yung ating cord compression. But never ever na ipu-push back mo yung ating protruding umbilical cord back into the vagina. So, yun po yung ating gagawin kapag meron po tayong prolapse umbilical cord. Again, so ang una mong gagawin, reposition the mother into knee chest position, or kapag walang knee chest position, we have your slight Trendelenburg position. Then next is we have your cover your protruding cord with your sterile gauze wet with your NSS or normal saline solution. And kapag nakita mo yung kanyang presenting part, pwede mo siyang i-push up, okay? Push up or lift up the presenting part slightly to relieve your compression on the cord, but never ever push back the cord back into the vagina. The next question is question number 46. The painful phenomenon known as the back labor occurs in a client whose fetus is in what position? A. Bro position. B. Right occipito anterior position. C. Bridge position. Or letter D. Left occipito posterior position. So remember, sabi ko kanina, we have your normal position and the abnormal position of the baby in your uterus. Okay? So, sabi ko, ang normal position ay yung mga OA, mga occipito anterior position. So, yun yung mga normal. Okay? Kasi yun ay nagpa-facilitate po yun ng easy delivery and a healthy delivery of the baby. Pero kapag ang inyong fetal position is occipito posterior, OP ang nakikita mo sa board exam, OP is painful because it causes severe back discomfort and it causes your prolonged labor process. So, alin dito sa ating choices ang nagpapakita ng OP position or the occipito posterior position known as the back labor kasi nga it causes your severe back pain, okay? So, the correct answer here is letter D, the left occipito posterior position kasi occipito posterior OP o painful position, okay? So, letter D is the correct answer here. Tandaan nyo po yan. So, OP is o painful, OA are okay, okay? Occipito anteriors are okay, OP positions are o painful positions. Okay, so letter D is the correct answer for question number 46. Then next, for question number 47, the Ligtas Buntis campaign of the DOH aims to achieve the following goals except A. Universal access to family planning, B. Maternal care formation, C. Services of men, or D. Services for aging couples. Okay, Ligtas Buntis campaign is the DOH campaign or program for a safe and healthy delivery. Okay? So, it includes your universal access to family planning, maternal care formation, and services to men and women. So, both sexes po yan. So, meron po tayo dyan, gender equality. So, the correct answer for your question number 47 is letter D, services for aging couples. Okay? So, yun po yung ating Ligtas Buntis campaign ng ating DOH. So, matagal na po yan yung ating program na Ligtas Buntis campaign. So, letter D is the correct answer here. Then, next, for question number 48, how can nurse contribute to the improvement of maternal and child health in the Philippines? So, one way is by knowing the 8 Millennium Development Goals. Which of the following two of the 8 goals are very specific to MCH? So, A, reduce child mortality and improve maternal health. B, eradicate extreme poverty and hunger and achieve universal primary education. C, promote gender equality, empower women and global partnership for health. Or letter D, combat HIV and ensure environmental sustainability. So, alin daw dito yung pinaka-specific ay MCH. So, the correct answer is what? Letter A, very obvious pong sagot natin dyan kasi maternal and child health nursing. So, letter A, child mortality and improvement of maternal health. That is your MDG. Okay? So, letter A, your reduced child mortality is the MDG number 4, while your improved maternal health is the MDG number 5. So, take note. So, pinaka-specific sa maternal child health is the MDG 4 and MDG 5. So, we have your to reduce child mortality by 75% or 2/3 in 2015 and to improve your maternal health by 75% or 3/4 by 2015. So, yun po yung ating MDG 4 and MDG 5. So, 2015 pa po yung ating MDGs. Meron na po tayong mga bagong goals ngayon and that is known as the Sustainable Development Goals. And take note that under your Sustainable Development Goals, all health-related MDGs are under your SDG number 3, okay? Kasi ang SDG number 3 or the Sustainable Development Goal, yun po yung tinatawag natin na health-centered SDG because it focuses to your health and well-being, okay? So, yun po yung ating tatandaan. Again, so the correct answer here is letter A, reduce child mortality and improve maternal health. Then next, for question number 49, Andrea is 29 years old, has just given birth 3 hours ago. The nurse assesses Andrea's perineum and noticed that the local discharge is moderate in amount and red in color. So, what type of lochia is this lochia? Okay, so A, Firium, B, Serosa, C, Rubra, or D, Alba. So, eliminate muna natin yung letter A kasi wala naman tayong lochia Firium. Okay, so B, C, or D. Take note. Ilang araw na daw siya or ilang oras na siyang nanganak? 3 hours ago pa nga lang, okay? So, take note that the first type of lochial discharge is the lochia rubra, okay? Lochia rubra is the color red lochia. So, that is your correct answer. Letter C is the correct answer. That is present 1 to 3 days. Kasi, take note, ilang letters ba ang ating word na red? Ang color red, R-E-D. So, tatlong letra po yan. So, tatlong araw mo lang ding dapat makikita yung ating red lochial discharge. Kasi, at the 4th day postpartum hanggang 7 days postpartum or hanggang 10 days postpartum, dapat ang makita mo na is the pinkish to brownish lochial discharge known as your lochia serosa. Then 10 days onwards, that is your lochia alba, which is the whitish or the creamy white lochial discharge. Again, so lochia rubra followed by your lochia serosa, then Lochia Alba. So RSA is our mnemonics. Rubra is red, Serosa is pinkish to brownish, and Alba is your whitish or creamy white Lochia. So the correct answer here is letter C, that is the Lochia Rubra. Then next, for question number 50, an 18 years old delivers to an 8-pound baby after 10 hours of labor. So in the postpartum period, which of the following would be a priority concern to assess for by the nurse? A. Endometritis, B. Thrombophlebitis, C. Bleeding, or D. Amniotic embolus. Okay, so take note, nanganak daw siya ng 8-pound baby. So 8-pound baby, so medyo malaki na po yan. And yung normal labor hours po ng mga nanay na nanganganak is nasa 8 to 12 hours po yan. So pasok pa po yan sa normal labor hours po yan. So ang sagot natin dito is bleeding pa rin. So letter C is the correct answer. Okay, priority concern to assess for by the nurse is bleeding. Kasi nga, pag nanganak ka ng medyo malaking baby or malaki-laking baby, possible po dito na mag-cause yan ng bleeding due to your what? Due to your lacerations in your cervix or your vagina, and due to your uterine atony. Kasi pag malaki masyado ang baby, pwede mag-relax din yung uterus mo after your delivery. So the correct answer here is letter B. Okay, so letter B po ang sagot natin sa ating question number 50. So ayan, so medyo nakakalahati na po tayo, nakalahati na po natin ng ating rationalization sa ating OB-pedia. So next questions po ay mga pediatric questions na po yan. Okay, so sa mga nagbibigay po ng ating super chat and super stickers, maraming salamat po ulit sa ating pagbibigay support sa ating channel. So sa mga gusto pong magbigay ng ating super chat and super stickers, pwede nyo pong i-click yung ating nasa live chat section, yung dollar sign dyan, at pili na lang po kayo dyan ng inyong ibibigay na super chat and super stickers. So malaking tulong na po yan para sa pag-grow ng ating channel. At para magkaroon po ulit tayo ng mga next na mga event or mga ganitong ganap dito sa ating channel para sa inyong nalalapit na board exam. Okay, so yun po yung ating next na exam naman nating gaganapin dito is siguro ay yung psychiatric nursing o di kaya ay medical surgical nursing. Okay, maraming salamat po. So magpatuloy po tayo sa ating rationalization for your question number 51. Okay, so next, bago tayo magpatuloy sa ating question number 51, i-correct ko lamang po yung aking nasabi sa aking question number 50 kanina, which is ang tamang sagot po doon is letter C, which is bleeding po dapat, hindi letter B. Nasabi ko kasi ay letter B, so dapat letter C po ang ating tamang sagot. So next, question number 51. The NICU nurse prepares for the arrival of the newborn with Myelome Nigoxil. Which of the following priority items should be placed at the newborn's bedside? A. Specific gravity urinometer, B. Rectal thermometer, C. Blood pressure cuff, or D. Bottle of your sterile normal saline. So, what is Myelome Nigoxil muna? So, pag sinabi po natin Myelome Nigoxil, it is a form of your neural tube defect where there is a sac protrusion containing your spinal cord, CSF, and the meninges with roots embedded in the wall. Myelome means your what? Myelome means your spinal cord, meninges with your meningocele, and cell means your sac protrusion. So, a sac protrusion containing spinal cord, CSF, and meninges with roots embedded in the wall of this sac. Okay? So, ano gagawin natin kapag meron pong myelome meningocele ang bata? So, take note, dapat lagi pong nasa bedside ng ating patient na merong myelome meningocele itong bottle of sterile normal saline. Why? Kasi kailangan po natin mag-apply ng sterile dressing moistened in a warm sterile saline solution sa kanyang protrusion or sa sac na nakaprotrude sa kanyang lumbosacral area. So dapat din nurses and midwives na dapat i-change din natin yung dressings na yan every 2 hours and not allow it to dry. Tandaan natin yan, not allow it to dry to avoid damage to the covering of the sac. Then place also the newborn in prone position to avoid any pressure on the defect. So the best position for your patient or for a child with unrepaired myelome meningocele is your prone position. And do not forget to hydrate the child. So begin with IV fluids also again. So pag meron po tayong patient or a child with your myelome meningocele, always place on the bedside yung ating bottle of sterile normal saline. Then apply sterile dressing moistened in a warm sterile saline solution to your protruding sac. And always remember to change the dressing every 2 hours and not allow it to air dried. Okay? So that is to avoid damage to the covering of the sac. And the best position of the newborn or the child is prone position to avoid any pressure on the defect or to the Myelo meningococcal. So that is your Myelo meningococcal, and that is a form of your neural tube defect. And tandaan natin na mga neural tube defect na yan ay pwede pong maiwasan ng mga nanay na buntis sa pag-take nila ng folic acid with 400 microgram or 0.4 milligram daily po yan, okay? From the first trimester up to the end of their pregnancy period. So, letter D is the correct answer here. Not letter A, B, or C. Mali po yung mga yan. So, hindi mo kailangan yan sa ating patient na merong Myelo meningococcal. So, the correct answer here is letter D. Bottle of sterile normal saline. Then next, for question number 52, which of the following is the primary reason for surgical repair of your Myelo meningococcal? So, the primary reason is 2. A. Decrease the risk of infection. B. Correct the neurologic defect. C. Prevent seizure disorders. Or letter D. Prevent hydrocephalus. Okay, so ano daw dito yung primary reason kung bakit kailangan natin i-surgical repair yung Myelo meningococcal? So, take note, nurses and midwives, kaya po natin in-early na repair yung ating Myelo meningococcal, that is to prevent your infection. Kasi nga, open yung sac natin na nakaprotrude sa kanyang lumbosacral area or sa likod ni baby. So, pag hinayaan natin na naka-expose yan into the air, possible po yan na mag-cause ng infection. Especially kapag nag-dry yung sac na yan at magkaroon ng entry point ng microorganism. And take note, napaka-delikado po yan kasi nga, meninges at spinal cord po ang pinag-usapan dyan, okay? So, the correct answer here is letter A. So, decrease the risk of infection, that is the primary reason for the early surgical repair of your Myelo meningococcal. So, although na ang ating Myelo meningococcal ay pwedeng mag-cause ng ating hydrocephalus, risk lamang po yun, okay? Risk for your hydrocephalus lamang din po yun. Pero hindi lagi naman na nagkakause ng hydrocephalus. So, pagtanong ka sa board exam kung ano yung pinaka-complication ng ating Myelo meningococcal, your answer is your risk of your hydrocephalus. Pero yung reason natin kung bakit kailangan natin siyang operahan ay yung ating risk of infection. Letter A is the correct answer here. So this is a common board question. So letter A, this is to decrease the risk of your infection, not to correct the neurologic defect, and not to prevent seizure disorder. So letter A is the best answer for your question number 52. And that is an NCLEX-based question. So letter A is the correct answer here. And next, for question number 53, a mother of a 3-year-old asks a clinic nurse about appropriate and safe toys for the child. The nurse tells the mother that the most appropriate toy for a 3-year-old is which of the following? A. A wagon cart. B. Large blocks. C. A farm set. Or letter D. Colored mobile. So here in your question number 53, ang tanong po dito ay yung 3-year-old child natin. So, 3-year-old na po siya, ano daw yung pinaka-most appropriate na laruan para sa 3-year-old? So, A, B, C, or D. So, mag-eliminate muna tayo dito. Una nating tatanggalin dito ang letter C, farm set toy, okay? So, a farm set toy may contain small items that the child could swallow that may lead to your aspirations. Pag sinabi mong farm set toy, may mga malilit na parts po yan na pwedeng mag-aspirate kay baby. So, not appropriate yung ating letter C kasi tandaan natin, pag tayo pipili ng mga toys ng mga babies or mga children, dapat ang pinaka-utmost priority natin and concern is the safety of the child for that toy. Okay? Gaano man kaganda yan, kung hindi naman siya safe, useless po yan at hindi po yan naaangkop. So, letter C is eliminated. Next, letter B, large blocks. So, itong large blocks natin, this is most appropriate sa mga 8 months old. So, pag mga 8 months old, ang pinaka-appropriate dyan ay mga large blocks, large cubes. So, yan yung pinaka-appropriate kapag 8 months yung bata. So, letter B, 8 months yung bata dyan. So, between letter A and letter D, alin dapat dito ang ating isagot? Kasi 3-year-old naman na yan. So, nakakalakad na yan, nakakatakbo na rin yung bata dyan. So, pinakamaganda at pinakamos appropriate na laruan dyan, nurses and midwives, ay letter A, mga wagon cart. Okay, mga bagon-bagon. Mga push and pull toys kung tawagin natin. So, push and pull toys are the most appropriate toy for your 3-year-old. So, not only your 3 years old, 1 to 3 years old, ang pinaka-appropriate dyan ay mga push and pull toys. So, bawal dyan yung mga golf set, mga jacks, and marbles, bawal din yung ating farm set. Kasi may mga malilit na pieces dyan na pwede mag-cause ng aspiration at mag-lead sa asphyxia sa bata. So, bawal po yun. Next, ang tatandaan natin pag walang push and pull toys sa ating choices, you can also answer yung mga large balls, large crayons, large trucks, and dolls kapag babae naman. So, yun yung mga pwede kapag nasa, ano na yun, mga sa toddlerhood period na, 1 to 3 years old, yun yung mga pwede nating ibigay sa mga batang yun, okay? Push and pull toys, like your wagon cart, large balls, large crayon, large trucks, and dolls. Okay? So, wag lang yung mga farm set toys, yung mga Jack's Marble set, ano pa, yung ating mga ano, yung mga golf set, bawal po yun. Kasi nga, may mga small pieces yan na magkukos ng aspiration na pwedeng iswalo ng bata. Yung ating letter din naman, yung ating mobile naman, that is most appropriate sa mga 3 months old. Yung mga color for mobile toys with music, that is most appropriate sa mga 3 months old baby, okay? So, the correct answer here is letter A, wagon cart po ang pinaka most appropriate kapag 3 years old na yung bata, okay? Then next, for question number 54, the head nurse of pediatric ward asks a staff nurse who is assigned to a 3-month-old infant, at what age will her patient start to drink from a cup? The staff nurse answer should be A, 12, B, 24, C, 9, or D, 5. So, ang tanong po dito, kailan daw pwedeng makainom yung baby niya sa cup? A, B, C, or D? So, take note that is an NCLEX-based question and the correct answer here is letter D, okay? 5 months, the child can able now to drink from a cup. So, the patient here can start now to drink from a cup. So, pwede mo nang i-train niya sa ating cup. So, that's your letter D, 5 months. Sa letter C natin, 9 months, the baby here can creep. Okay? Nag-creep na po yung baby at 9 months. At 12 months naman, the 12 months naman is ano, the baby here can eat all types of table foods. It's well with fingers. Okay? It's well with fingers at 12 months. Sa letter B naman, 24 months or 2 years old, the baby here can drink into a cup with minimal spilling. So, 24 months naman po yun. So, mali din ang ating 24 kasi masyado matagal. Kasi ang tanong is, when will her patient start to drink from a cup? So, the correct answer here is letter D. 5 months pa lang yung baby, pwede mo nang i-train at pwede na siyang makainom sa cup niya. Okay, so letter D is the correct answer. So, again, sabi ko kanina, that is an NCLEX-based question. So, ang sagot sa ating NCLEX question na yan is letter D. Okay? The next question, number 55, the toddler years are time of great cognitive, emotional, and social development. The toddler is a child blank months old. A, 6 to 12 months. B, 9 to 36 months. C, 36 to 48 months. Or D, 12 to 36 months. So, ang tanong po dito is kung ano daw yung toddler years natin. So, pag sinabi po natin toddler, yan po yung mga edad 1 hanggang 3 taong gulang. So, 1 to 3 years old po kapag ito ay toddler. Sabi ko kanina. So, 1 year old is 12 months and 3 years old is 36 months. So, the correct answer here is letter D. 12 to 36 months po yung ating toddler. So, take note, nurses and midwives, that toddlerhood is under your anal stage of your Sigmund Freud psychosexual theory. Okay? And the task of your toddler is what? Autonomy versus shame and doubt. So, between 12 to 36 months, kailangan matrained mo yung baby dito with your toilet training and your bowel training. So, bladder training and bowel training. So, mas nauna din dito yung ating bowel training bago yung ating bladder training. Yung bowel training, you can start it as early as 18 months. At yung bladder training naman, pwede yan sa 2 years old. So, letter D is the correct answer here. 12 to 36 months, that is your toddlerhood years. So, letter D is the correct answer for question number 55. Kasi yung ating letter A, that is still under infancy period. So, letter D is your toddlerhood years. So, letter D is the correct answer here. Dog po pala, 12 to 36 years. Okay, the next question, number 56. Nurse Linda is attending to a 2-year-old Deneng who was admitted due to a chronic bronchitis. Lenlen sports a long hair that extends up to her shoulder. As part of the morning care, Lenlen's hair into a ponytail. However, Lenlen vehemently resisted that her hair being tied by a rubber band. The best thing that Nurse Linda should do is which of the following? A. Nurse Linda decided to style Lenlen. B. Assert her authority. C. Denies Lenlen's preference that a ponytail would make Lenlen more beautiful. Or D. Allow Lenlen's preference. So, dito po sa ating question number 56, ang edad po ng ating patient or client is 2 years old. Okay? So, 2 years old na po si Lenlen. So, nasa toddlerhood period po siya. So, ano po ba ang task ng matoddler? Ang task po ng matoddler natin is autonomy versus shame and doubt. So, they quest for their autonomy. So, as a toddler or 1 to 3 years old begin to explore the world, they learn that they can control their actions and act on the environment to get the result. Okay? So they begin to show clear preferences for certain elements like your environment, like your food, like your toys, and your clothing. So, ito po yung tinatawag natin na me-do-it stage. Okay? Kasi me-do-it stage kasi nga ito yung ating stage kung saan yung bata ay nag-request ng kanyang independence or autonomy. So, ang gagawin natin dito, pinakamainam is to allow the preference of the child para magkaroon po sila ng sense of autonomy or independence. Kasi the main task of the child in this period or stage is to resolve the issue between your autonomy and your shame and doubt. Kasi pag dinenay mo ang kanyang preference, pwedeng ma-develop sa kanya yung ating shame. Okay? So the correct answer here is letter D, allow Lenlen's preference, and take note, yan ay lumalabas palagi sa board exam. So twice na po yan na lumabas sa board exam. So again, in your question number 56, the correct answer here is letter D, allow Lenlen's preference. So take note, nagbabago-bago po yung pangalan ng ating patient at saka nurse sa board exam. Okay, so next question number 57, a child is hospitalized because of your persistent vomiting. The nurse should monitor the child closely for which problem? A. Diarrhea, B. Metabolic acidosis, C. Metabolic alkalosis, or D. Hyperactive bowel sounds. So, ano daw dito? Nurse should monitor the child closely for which problem? So, take note, ang problem ng bata is persistent vomiting. So, take note that in vomiting, it causes a loss in your hydrochloric acid and subsequently, it causes your metabolic alkalosis kasi vomiting. So, pag nagsusuka, that is alkalosis. Tandaan yan. So, alkalosis, it causes metabolic alkalosis kapag ito ay nag-vomit. Okay? Pero pag sinabi kasi natin metabolic acidosis would occur in a child experiencing diarrhea, okay? Because of the loss of bicarbonate and not for your vomiting. Again, so pag vomiting, metabolic alkalosis po yan, okay? Pero pag diarrhea or diarrhea, that is metabolic acidosis. Kasi pag nagtatay yung bata, it causes loss of your bicarbonate. Pero pag nagsusuka naman ng bata, it causes your loss of your hydrochloric acid, causing your alkalosis state. So, letter C is the correct answer for question number 57. So, alam nyo na yan. So, metabolic alkalosis kapag nagvavamit. Kasi, nagvavamit po siya, nagsusuka, nilalabas niya yung hydrochloric acid. So, nagiging alkalosis yung kanyang pH. So, metabolic alkalosis kapag nagvavamit, and metabolic acidosis naman kapag nagdiarrhea or diarrhea yung bata. So, letter C is the correct answer here. Then next, for question number 58, the goal of neutral thermal environment is to assist the newborn to stabilize its temperature that does not drop below which of the following? A. 98.6 degrees Fahrenheit, D. 99.5 degrees Fahrenheit, C. 97.7 degrees Fahrenheit, or letter D. 96.7 degrees Fahrenheit. So take note that the normal newborn's temperature, MAPA term and preterm, it should be 36.5 to 37.5. Tadaan nyo yan. So 36.5 degrees Celsius to 37.5 degrees Celsius dapat yung ating normal range of your body temperature naman newborn. So in your Fahrenheit, it should be 97.7 degrees Fahrenheit and up to 99.5 degrees Fahrenheit. Ulitin ko, 97.7 degrees Fahrenheit to 99.5 degrees Fahrenheit. So the temperature should not drop below your 97.7 degrees Fahrenheit. So take note that newborns are prone to cold stress, okay? So pwede pong mag-loss yung kanilang body heat by means of your conduction, convection, radiation, and evaporation. So kailangan ma-maintain po natin yung kanilang body temperature kasi nga they easily lose body heat because of their body surface area and they have the inability to shiver. So hindi pa nila alam mag-shiver and the lack of your brown fats for your body heat, okay? For your body heat production. So the correct answer here is letter C. 97.7 po. Kailangan hindi bumaba ng 36.5 ang kanilang body temperature. So dapat may stabilize mo po ang kanilang temperature 8 to 12 hours after their delivery. So the correct answer here is letter C. 97.7 degrees Fahrenheit is the correct answer here. So the body temperature should not drop below 97.7 degrees Fahrenheit or less than 36.5 degrees Fahrenheit. Then next, for question number 59, a hospitalized child, TJ, a 4 years old, being away from his home in normal environment, goes through separation anxiety. So which of the following behaviors might indicate that TJ is in the denial stage of separation? He blanks. A. He searches for the caregiver and waits for her to arrive. B. He quietly lies in the crib when no one is in the room. C. He ignores the caregivers when they visit. Or letter D. He cries loudly even when being helped by the nurse. Okay? So, separation anxiety po, stages po ang pinag-uusapan natin dito. So, ano po ba yung mga stages ng ating separation anxiety? So, take note, nurses and midwives, we have your 3 stages of your separation. Okay? So, our number 1 stage is the protest. Okay? Protest stage. Number 2 stage is the despair stage. And number 3 stage is the denial or the detachment stage. Ulitin ko, the first stage is protest. Okay? Nagpro-protesta yung bata. Okay? First stage is the protest stage. So, sa protest stage natin, the child here usually cries. Okay? And often refuses to be comforted. So, ayaw niyang pinapacify po siya. Iyak lang po siya ng iyak. And the child here constantly seeks the primary caregiver at every sight and every sound. So, ibig sabihin yan, yung ating letter D, cries loudly even when being helped by the nurse, that is under your first stage of your separation anxiety, and that is your protest stage. Hindi po yan denial. So, mali na po ang ating letter D, okay? So, next, ang second stage ng ating separation is, tinatawag natin siyang despair stage. So, despair ang second stage ng ating separation. So, the child here begins to withdraw from others, and the child stays depressed. So, bumabalik siya sa kanyang pagkabata lalo kasi nandito yung bedwetting, thumbsucking because of your fear and your anxiety. Okay? So, kapag wini-withdraw ng bata ang sarili niya sa iba at lalo siyang nade-depress, nagtatambsak na siya, nagbe-bedwet na po siya, that is under the second stage of your separation anxiety. And that is your despair stage of your separation. So, ibig sabihin yan, itong letter B natin, quietly lies in the crib when no one is in the room, that is under the second stage of your separation. And that is this despair stage of the separation process. So, mali ang ating letter B kasi tinatanong po dito is denial stage. Okay? So, the next and third stage po ng separation is your denial stage or yung tatawag natin na detachment stage. At yan po yung tinatanong dyan sa ating board question or common board question. So, take note, kapag nasa denial stage na po tayo dito sa ating separation, the child will show distrust and rejection of the caregiver. So, meron ng distrust and rejection. So, pag bibisita ang caregiver, the child will appear to ignore the caregiver and distrust them. And it will last for a long time. Tandaan nyo po yan. So, for your question number 59, denial stage of separation, the correct answer here is letter C. It ignores caregivers when they visit. Okay, so letter C is the correct answer. So yung letter A tsaka letter D, that is your first stage protest. Then letter B is your second stage despair. And letter C is your third stage denial stage. Okay, so letter C is the correct answer for your question number 59. Then next, for question number 60, after TJ, a 4-year-old, discharged from the hospital, which behavior might indicate that he is afraid of another separation? He, A, plays with siblings for long periods of time. B, wakes up very early in the morning. Or C, requests to visit the nurse at the hospital. Or D, carries favorite blanket around the house. So, ano daw dito yung behavior niya that will indicate that he is afraid for another separation? So, take note, in your question number 60, the correct answer here is letter D, kasi yung A, B, C, hindi po yan nagpapakita ng ano, takot siya sa another separation. Okay, so wala pa siya dyang separation anxiety. Kasi sa letter D, it shows that the child has a separation anxiety here in your letter D. Kasi it carries your favorite blanket and around the house. So, yung favorite blanket po niya tsaka favorite toys niya, yan po yung mga security blanket niya kung tawagin natin. So, this will help the child to reduce the anxiety and fear for your separation anxiety. So, the correct answer for question number 60 is letter D. So, pag dala-dala niya yung paborito niyang kumot at laruan, nare-reduce po natin yung kanyang separation anxiety. So, pag hawak-hawak niya yung kanyang security blanket, sign po yan na, ano, Sign po yan na si baby merong separation anxiety. Kanya hawak-hawak yun para maibsan or ma-reduce yung kanyang takot. Okay, yung fear and anxiety niya related to separation. So the correct answer here is letter D, carries favorite blanket around the house. Okay, the next question, number 61. For an infant born with a unilateral cleft lip and palate, which of the following type of feeding will be best to use? A. Rubber tip syringe or medicine dropper. B. IV fluids on limited number of ounces. C. Full breastfeeding or D. Cross-cut rubber nipple. Okay? So take note, meron po tayo ditong unilateral cleft lip and cleft palate. So take note, itong mga cleft lip and cleft palate nito, isang rason kung bakit nagkakaroon yung bata dyan is exposure to maternal drug intake during pregnancy and the lack of your folic acid intake during the first trimester of your pregnancy or the period of organogenesis. Okay? So ngayon, ang tanong dito is which of the following type of feeding will be best to use? So, eliminate muna tayo ng ating choices. So, letter C, tanggal muna ang ating letter C kasi take note, when there is a problem in your cleft lip or cleft palate, the child or the baby has the inability to maintain suction to the nipple. So, hindi po niya kayang mag-maintain ng suction sa nipple, so hindi po advisable yung ating breastfeeding dito. Kasi nga, baka kabagin lang yung baby or mag-cause lang yan ng abdominal tympani o yung tatawag natin na colic. Kasi nga, more on air na lamang po ang ma-ingest nila kaysa gatas, okay? So, ang pinaka-the best po dito natin gagawin is to feed the baby or the newborn with a rubber tip syringe or medicine dropper. So, okay din sana ang ating letter D. Kaso, hindi lahat ng mga newborn or mga bata is may ability po na uminom or mag-feed by your cross-cut rubber nipple. So, hindi lahat ay kaya ma-feed with your cross-cut rubber nipple. So, pinaka-appropriate po dito is letter A and that is an NCLEX-based question. At kapag babasahin mo po ang ating libro, yan po ang ating number one na ina-advocate na gamitin natin kapag tayo mag-feed ng mga batang may cleft lip and cleft palate. Okay, so letter A is the best answer for your question number 61. Then next, for question number 62, this is a common board question. So ringworm is frequently found in school children. It is caused by which of the following? A. Virus. B. Fungus. Si parasite or the bacterial infection. So pag sinabi po nating ringworm is caused by your fungus, okay? So letter B is the correct answer for your question number 62. Hindi po siya caused ng virus, hindi po causative agent diyan ay bacteria. So the causative agent in your ringworm is your fungus. Letter B is the correct answer here. So a ringworm is a common skin and nail infection which is caused by a fungus. And kaya siya tinawag na ringworm because of the presence of your circular rash, okay? So meron po kasi tayo dito mapabilog-bilog na mga itchy rashes, okay? So yun po ay cause ng ating fungus. So pagtanongin naman kayo sa board exam kung ano naman yung ating herbal med for your ringworm, your answer is the Acapulco, okay? Kasi ang Acapulco ay tinatawag natin na ringworm bush, okay? So take note, ang causative agent ng ringworm ay fungus, not a virus, not a parasite, and not a bacterial infection. So the correct answer here is letter C. Then next, for question number 63, which of the following is usually the only symptom of pediculosis, capitis, or head lice? Kuto, okay? So A. Itching. B. Vesicles. C. Scalp rash. Or D. Localized inflammatory response. So ano daw yung only symptom ng pediculosis, capitis? So pag meron kang pediculosis or lice infestation, meron tayong tatlong klase ng lice infestation. We have your pediculosis capitis, which is sa ulo or sa buhok. The next, pediculosis corposis sa katawan or sa body. And the pediculosis pubis, kung saan yun yung nangangati yung kanyang pubic area. Okay? So, pag sinabi natin pediculosis capitis, head lice po yan. Kuto po yan ng ating mga buhok sa ulo. Okay? So, ano daw yung only symptom ng ating pediculosis capitis? A, B, C, or D? So, pag may kuto, ang pinakasintomas na meron kang kuto or mga lice is letter A, itching. Usually, makati po ang inyong ulo kapag ikaw ay may pediculosis or head lice infestation. So, the correct answer for your question number 63 is itching. Not vesicles, not scalp rash, and not your localized inflammatory response. And kapag napabayaan po itong ating head lice infestation, it can also lead to our anemia condition. Kasi take note, yung mga kuto na yan ay a form of parasite po yan. Sinisipsip po niyang dugo mo, kaya nagkukos po yan ng ating anemia. Okay? So the correct answer here, only symptom of pediculosis capitis is letter A. So, pwede po natin siyang patayin gamit ang ating pediculoside or mga ginagamit natin na pamatay ng kuto. Ano pa? Pwede rin natin isuffocate yung mga kuto using your ano, yung mga lalagyan mo ng head plastic yung ulo mo kapag maliligo ka, pag mag-shower ka, dapat balutin mo yung ulo mo ng plastic para ma-suffocate po yung kuto. Then, susuyurin mo siya. Okay? The next, pwede mo rin pong yung mga laruan ng bata, mga bedsheet, mga linens, at saka yung mga laruan niya, stuffed toys niya, pwede mo po siyang isilid sa black bag or mga garbage bag, then hayaan mo siya nakasilid doon ng 24 to 48 hours kasi mamamatay po yung kuto doon kapag hindi po sila nakasipsip ng dugo. Kasi take note, parasite po sila. So, kailangan po nila ng host para sila ay mag-survive. Okay? So, the correct answer here is letter A. It is your itchiness or your pruritus of the head. Okay? Then next, for our question number 64, the most common symptom of scabies that the family of a child with scabies would report to nurse is A, rashes, B, swelling, C, scaling, or D, itchiness. Okay. So, ang tanong dito is the most common symptom of your scabies. So, possible kasi magkaroon ng scaling dyan, rashes, swelling, pero ano daw yung pinaka most common? So, take note that scabies is caused by your parasite, okay? Not a fungus. It is caused by parasite, not a virus, not a bacteria, and not a fungus. It is caused by your parasite. Ang parasite na po yan ay tinatawag natin na itch mite, which causes tunneling, okay? So, nagtatunneling po yan underneath of your skin at doon po siya naglilay ng kanyang eggs, okay? Yung itlog na yun, pag napisa, another mites na naman po yun. So, kailangan kapag gagamutin natin ng ating scabies, kailangan all over the body po tayo mag-apply ng ating permethrin ointment, not only to the areas na meron po tayo mga scalings or mga tunneling. So, kailangan head to toe po tayo maglagay ng ating cream kapag maglalagay ng permethrin. Kasi nga, sabi ko nga kanina, kailangan natin lagyan lahat ng parte ng katawan natin para mamatay po lahat ng ating itch mite. Okay, so ang tanong dito is, what is the most common symptom of your scabies? So take note, nurses and midwives, kapag may scabies ka, common dito yung makati ang iyong balat. Okay, that is the most common symptom of your scabies. So that is your pruritus or itchiness. Okay, pruritus or itchiness is the most common sign of your scabies. And so the correct answer here is letter D, okay? Letter D, itchiness is the correct answer here. Then next, for question number 65, in providing health teaching to the family, the nurse would include in her teachings the etiology of scabies, which is A, virus, B, fungi, C, bacteria, or D, parasite. So, kakasabi ko lamang po yung ating causative agent dito ay hindi virus, hindi fungi, hindi bacteria, kundi parasite po yan. So, it is a form of itch mite that causes tunneling. And naglalay po siya ng egg doon sa tunnels na ginawa niya that causes your inflammatory reaction and your allergy, okay? That causes your itchiness at nag-release po yan ng certain substances. So, letter D is the correct answer here. Parasite po yan. So, para maiwasan po natin yung ating pagkahawa sa ating scabies, dapat kung alagaan po natin ang mga pasyente may scabies, always use your gloves. Kasi nga, take note that scabies is primarily transmitted via contact, okay? Indirect man yan or direct contact, pwedeng mahawaan ka ng ating scabies. So, hindi ka po magmamask dito kasi hindi mo naman nalalanghap yung ating itch mite. So, again, so the primary mode of transmission of your scabies is your contact by means of direct or indirect contact. So, pag direct contact, kapag nagkaroon ka ng skin-to-skin contact or nahawakan mo yung mismong tunnels na merong itch mite, okay? Or naipasa sa iyong itlog ng ating itch mite. Or, kapag isinuot mo yung damit ng pasyenteng may scabies or nahiga ka sa kanyang kama with a bedsheet contaminated with your itch mite or yung eggs nito, okay? So, mainam nang gawin natin is labhan natin yung mga beddings, yung mga damit niya with your hot water. Or, kapag tayo magda-dry, kailangan hot dryer po ang ating ginagamit. Again, so in your question number 65, ang sagot natin dito is letter D, parasite po ang ating causative agent pagdating kay scabies. And take note, lumabas na po yan sa board exam. So, tandaan natin, scabies is parasite, while your ringworm is caused by fungus or your fungi. Okay, again, so scabies is parasite, ringworm is fungi. So, that is your letter D. Scabies is caused by parasite. Then next, for question number 66, the mother of an infant asks you when to begin brushing her son's teeth. Your best response would be A, as soon as he begins to eat fruit, B, as soon as the first tooth erupts, or C, when weaning is complete, or letter D, by 12 months of age. Okay, so when is the best time for brushing teeth? Okay, so take note,
The best time to brush teeth of your newborn or your child is as soon as he begins to eat fruit daw. Mali po yan, okay? Mali ang letter A. So, the correct answer here is letter B, as soon as the first tooth erupts. Okay? So, pag meron na po siyang ngipin, pwede na po natin siyang i-toothbrush. Pero ang gagamitin natin ditong toothpaste ay yung mga wala pang fluoride content because of the risk of fluorouracis. Okay? So, letter B is the correct answer. So, usually, the first tooth bud erupts at the age of 6 months. And that is the first two lower central incisors. Tandaan niyo po yan. The first two central incisors are the first set of teeth that erupts in your newborn. Usually, it occurs at 6 months. So, pag may ngipin na po siya, pwede na po natin siyang i-toothbrush. Okay? Pero kailangan, kapag ito-toothbrush po natin yung bata, kailangan ang gamitin natin toothpaste ay wala pang fluoride content kasi yung fluoride ay makakapag-cause yan ng fluorouracis kapag na-ingest po yan ng bata or kapag naswallow po yan ng bata. Kasi nga, minsan may mga bata kasi na hindi pa marunong spit out yung kanilang pinag-toothbrush yan. Okay? So, the correct answer here is letter B, as soon as the first tooth erupts. Kasi yung letter C, when weaning is complete, di mo naman masabi kung kailan siya mawiwin sa inyong breastfeeding, okay? Kaya ang pinaka-the best dyan is letter B, as soon as the first tooth erupts. And that is a common board question. Then next, for question number 67, when talking with a parent about tooth eruption, the nurse explains that the first deciduous teeth to erupt are the blank incisors. A, lower central, B, upper central, C, lower lateral, or D, upper lateral. So, take note, meron po tayong dalawang klase dito ng ngipin. The primary teeth or the primary dentition at saka yung secondary dentition. So, pag sinabi po natin primary dentition, ito po yung mga deciduous teeth natin. At kapag sinabi naman natin na secondary dentition, these are the permanent teeth. Okay? So, pag sinabi natin deciduous teeth, ang una po nag-erupt dito at the age of 6 months ng bata is the lower central incisors. So, letter A is the correct answer here, okay? Again, so the first deciduous teeth to erupt are the lower central incisors. So, letter A is the correct answer here. Number 68, the nurse observes a 10-month-old infant using her index finger and thumb to pick up pieces of cereals. This behavior is evidence that the infant has developed A, the pincer grasp, B, a grasp reflex, C, prehension ability, or D, the parachute reflex. So, nakakaano daw siya. Able na daw po siyang mag-pick ng ating cereal. So, cereals are small objects. So, kaya na po niya yung ating tinatawag na pincer grasp. Okay? So, this is an evidence na nakapag-develop na yung baby ng pincer grasp reflex. So, at the age of 9 months to 11 months, yan po yung ating makikita na fine motor development ng bata. The development of your pincer grasp. Okay? So, the thumb and index grasp is your pincer grasp reflex and evident na po yan from age 9 months to 11 months. And very neat na po yan at the age of 12 months. Again, so the correct answer here is letter A, the pincer grasp reflex that is evident at 9 to 11 months and very fine na po yan at the age of 12 months. Okay? So, very neat na ang kanyang pincer grasp at 12 months. So, yun yung ating tatandaan. So, letter A is the correct answer here. Then next, for question number 69, another new mother is concerned about the developmental milestone of her son who is 7 months old. Which of the following statements by the new mother indicates that your health teaching was effective? A, he can crawl. B, my son can sit without support. C, he can stand up from sitting position. Or D, he can drink from his training cup with minimal spilling. Okay, 7 months old na po yung bata. So, mag-eliminate muna tayo dito. So, ang una nating tatanggalin dito, nurses and midwives, ay letter D. Kasi nga, yung ating letter D ay common po yan sa mga 2 years old or 24 months old children. Okay? So, mali po ang ating letter D for your 7 months old kasi mas kaya po yung gawin ng 2 years old or 24 months. Then, pangalawang tatanggalin natin dito is letter B, my son can sit without support. So, sitting alone or sitting without support is a developmental milestone or task of your 8 months old. So, hindi pa po yan kaya ng 7 months old. So, possible nakaupo na yung 7 months old pero may support pa po dapat yan. Kasi at 8 months, dun pa lang siya nakakapag-sit alone. So, mali din po ang ating letter B. Then, letter C, he can stand up from a sitting position. Mali, okay? From sitting to standing position, common po yan sa 10 months po. Common sa 10 months old infant. So, the correct answer here is letter A, he can crawl now. Why? Kasi at 7 months,
Ang bata po ay pwede na mag-crawl dito. Okay? At 9 months, the child can now creep. Okay? Creep with 4 hands, that is your 9 months. Crawling is 7 months. Again, crawling starts at 7 months. Creeping starts at 9 months. Magkaiba po kasi yun. Pag crawl, nagko-crawl lang siya. Pag creep, kaya po niyang gamitin yung kanyang kamay at paa para mag-crawl siya. So, creeping with 4 hands, that is your, four extremities, yung kamay niya, tsaka paa niya, that is at 9 months. Okay? So, pag crawling, that is 7 months. Kapag creeping, that is 9 months. So, the correct answer here is letter A. The child now can crawl. And take note also, nurses and midwives, meron pa tayong isang common board question sa 7 months old infant. Ito yung kanyang ability to transfer object from one hand to another, or yung tatawag natin na hand-to-hand coordination. So, kaya na po niyang paglipat-lipatin yung mga objects na nasa kamay niya from one hand to another. So, that is also a developmental milestone of your 7 months old infant. Okay? So, again, the correct answer here is letter A. The child now for 7 months old is crawling. So, letter A, he can crawl. And next, question number 70. You encourage a first-timer mother to talk to her child, a 9-month-old girl, who at this age should be A, saying dada, B, cooing when talked to, C, obeying simple commands, or D, vocalizing single syllables. Okay. So, 9-month-old girl. So, cooing, tanggal na po yung ating letter B. So, yung cooing kasi, common na po yan at the age of 2 months. So, pag 9 months na yan, that is the age for the first word of the baby. And the first word of the baby is dada. Okay? So, dada, dada, dada. So, the first word of the baby is dada followed by mama. Okay? So, dada, mama. Dada is at the age of 9 months. So, the correct answer here is letter A, saying dada. And for question number 70, in further applying essential newborn care or the ENC, Nurse Nilda keeps in mind that care of the umbilicus should include A, cleansing with cold boiled water, B, covering with a sterile compress, C, applying antibiotic cream, or D, cleansing with alcohol. So, ano daw dito? Okay? Ano ba ang meron sa care of the cord sa ating ENC? So, take note, under your EINC protocol, bawal na pong maglagay ng any substances sa cord. Okay? Unless kapag nagkaroon po ng soiling of the cord. So kapag soiled ang cord or kapag madumi ang cord ni baby, ang tanging pwede mo lang gawin dito, nurses and midwives, is to cleanse it with a cold boiled water. Okay? So the correct answer in your question number 71 is letter A. Kasi letter B, letter C, and letter D are inappropriate intervention in the care of your umbilical cord. Kasi nga, kapag letter B kasi, covering can cause what? Can cause tetanus also. Kasi nga, take note, tetanus bacteria is anaerobic bacteria. Kaya pag kinocover mo yung cord, at kapag hindi naghilom yung sugat sa stump ng cord, it can cause tetanus neonatorum. Especially kapag, kapag merong sugat doon. Okay? And letter C, bawal naman po maglagay ng antibiotic cream. Hindi naman po yan advisable. And especially letter D, cleansing with alcohol. So, napatunayan po sa ating evidence practice na yung alcohol ay hindi po siya nakakadry talaga ng ating cord, kundi nakakapromote po yan ng ating moistness of the cord. So, ang alcohol ay hindi na rin po siya advocated ngayon na gamitin natin sa ating umbilical cord. So, the new ENC protocol now is apply nothing to the cord and let the cord expose to the air. Okay? So, air dry the cord until its detachment. Okay? And nade-detach po yan at the time of 7 to 10 days after your delivery. Again, apply nothing unto the cord. Bawal ang povidone iodine, bawal ang alcohol, bawal ang hydrogen peroxide, o yung tatawag natin na agua oxinada. Okay? So, bawal po mga yun. Again, so apply nothing on the cord. If the cord was soiled, so cleanse it with your cold boiled water and soap. Okay? So, that is letter A. And pat it to dry, syempre. Okay? So, A is the correct answer for your question number 71. Then next, for question number 72, administration of vitamin K to the newborn is necessary since A, newborns have no intestinal bacteria, B, newborn's liver is incapable of producing vitamins, C, hemolysis of fetal RBCs destroys vitamin K, or letter D, newborns are susceptible to a vitaminosis. So, vitamin K. So, vitamin K is a form of vitamin that promotes your coagulation kasi it supports your prothrombin, okay? So, that is to prevent your bleeding disorders or yung hemorrhagic stroke of the newborn. So, alin dito ang rason kung bakit tayo nagbibigay ng vitamin K? So, number one reason to give vitamin K at birth is to prevent your bleeding, okay, or hemorrhage, abnormal bleeding of the newborn. And second reason here is the newborn was delivered sterile gut. Okay? Meron po siyang sterile gut. Ibig sabihin po niyan, wala pa po mga normal bacteria or mga normal flora sa kanyang intestines that will synthesize vitamin K. So, take note, at birth din kasi, medyo immature pa yung liver. Pero, hindi ibig sabihin nung nakapag-immature ang liver ay hindi na po yan nakakapag-produce ng vitamin. Again, still, ang liver ay capable ng mag-produce ng vitamins A, D, E, and K at kaya niya mag-store ng another nutrients and vitamins. Pero, ang pinakarason dyan kung bakit tayo nagbibigay ng vitamin K, kasi nga, sterile yung gut niya. So, wala pang mga bakterya na nasa kanyang tiyan na tutulong sa pag-synthesize ng vitamin K. And take note, nagbibigay po tayo ng vitamin K in the route of intramuscular injection at the left vastus lateralis with your 0.1 ml. Okay? 0.1 ml po ang tinuturok natin or equivalent to 1 milligram of your vitamin K. Again, so the correct answer here is letter A. Then next, for question number 73, the best reason why Nurse Faith opted to review Erikson's psychosocial theory, which of the following statement? A. Failure to master this task lead to feelings of inadequacy. B. Helps children grow into successful and contributing member society. C. Completion of task results in a sense of competence and healthy personality. Or letter D. We are motivated by the need to achieve competence in certain areas of our lives. So take note, this is a common board question. Paulit-ulit po itong lumalabas sa NP2. So, bakit daw kailangan nating i-review yung ating Erikson's psychosocial theory? So, number one reason kung bakit kailangan nating i-review yan is letter B. Because mastery of this psychosocial theory will help children grow into successful and contributing members of the society. So, letter B is the correct answer for question number 73. Although lahat po yan nasa ating option A, B, C, and D are reasons kung bakit kailangan natin alam ang ating psychosocial theory, pinaka-most important dyan kung bakit kailangan natin i-review yan is para ano daw? Para matulungan natin yung mga batang lumaki with a success into the society. So, to be successful and to be contributing members of the society. So, letter B is the correct answer because not mastering your psychosocial theory will lead to feelings of inadequacy. So again, so the correct answer here is letter B. Yan po yung ating number one reason or the best reason. Okay? So boy is the correct answer here. The next question number 74. Dodi, 17 years old, is admitted in a private room due to influenza. In one of Nurse Dina's conversation with Dodi, the patient expressed his unhappiness with the program he's taking up in college. This is not his choice, but rather the choice of his parents. In which of Erikson's stage development does this case fall? Again, 17 years old. So, pag 17 years old po yan, nasa age po yan ng adolescence group. Okay? And take note that under your adolescence in your Erik Erikson and your Sigmund Freud developmental theories, so, siya po ay nasa, ano, nasa psychosocial development task of your, ano, developmental task of your identity versus role confusion. So, A, B, C, or D, the correct answer here is letter C. That is a sign of identity versus role confusion. Kasi, hindi yung gusto niya ang nasunod, kundi ang kagustuhan ng kanyang mga magulang. So, there is a role confusion. Kasi, ayaw niya yung kanyang tinitake ngayon sa college. So, there is a role confusion. So, letter C is the correct answer here. Identity versus your role confusion. So, C po ang sagot dyan. Okay? Kasi dito sa ating question number 74, marami pong nagkakamali dyan kasi minsan ang sinasagot nila is letter A, autonomy. Mali po yan kasi pag autonomy versus shame and doubt, that is common developmental task na kayang na pwedeng i-resolve or dapat i-resolve ng mga toddlerhood. Okay? Mga nasa ages 1 to 3 years old. Pero itong ating pasyente dito sa ating number 74, 17 years old na po siya. Adolescence na po yan, okay? And under your adolescence period, the developmental task here or the psychosocial developmental task is your identity versus role confusion. So the correct answer here is letter C. At nakapaloob po yan sa ating Erik Erikson theory. Kapag yung isang bata, yung adolescent is ayaw niya yung kanyang ginagawa or na napipilitan lang siya sa kanyang ginagawa at iba ang kanyang gustong gawin, that is a role confusion. So letter C is the correct answer here, okay? Then next, Question number 75. A young female patient believes that doorknobs are contaminated with COVID-19 and refuses to touch them except with the aid of tissue paper. Her diagnosis of obsessive compulsive disorder constantly does repetitive cleaning. The nurse knows that this behavior is probably most basically an attempt to... Okay, so ito po yung naging maugong na mga situations sa board exam. So, common board questions na po ito mga ito. Nagbabago lamang po yung masakit, mga condition at mga pangalan ng tao. So, letter A, decrease the anxiety to a tolerable level. B, focus attention on non-threatening task. C, control others. Or D, decrease time available from interaction with people. Okay, ano pa dito? Ano ba ang ating tamang sagot dito? Bakit nga ba lagi niyang nililinisan yung ating doorknob with a tissue paper? Ano bang ibig sabihin nun? Okay, so in your question number 75, if we say obsessive compulsive disorder, so obsessions gives rise to anxiety of your client and the anxiety is then reduced by compulsive behaviors. So ginagawa ito ng bata kasi para ma-decrease po yung kanyang anxiety to a tolerable level, okay? So the correct answer here in your question number 75 is letter A. So take note, kapag meron po tayong client with your OCD or obsessive compulsive disorder, our appropriate intervention is to plan for a structured schedule of activities throughout the days. Okay? So plan a structured schedule of activity throughout the day. And ano pa? Teach the client for a relaxation exercise and tell the client to tolerate anxious feeling. So common kasi dito kapag meron siyang obsessional thoughts, na experience po ng ating patient with OCD ay nagiging intrusive, recurrent, uncontrollable, and unwanted po yung mga obsessional thoughts na yan. At kapag naka 8 times or more po siya ng obsessive thoughts in a day, that is categorized as a severe OCD. Again, severe OCD na po yan kapag 8 times a day pong pabalik-balik yung mga obsessive thoughts niya. Okay? Again, so OCD, obsessions gives rise to anxiety, and that anxiety is then reduced by compulsive behavior. Kaya siya ay ano, punas ng punas ng ating doorknob. That is her way to reduce the level of anxiety. So letter A is the correct answer here. Okay, then next, for question number 76, a 3-year-old child has all of the following abilities. So which did he acquire most recently? So most recently, 3 years old na po siya. So A, walking. B, throwing a large ball. C, riding a tricycle. Or D, stating his name. Okay, so kapag 3 years old po yung ating children or yung child dito, yung 3-year-old child, kaya po niyang mag-ride na sa tricycle. Okay, so the child now here can ride a tricycle kasi ang letter A, nagawa na po niya yan 12 to 15 months pa lang. Okay, 12 to 15 months pa lang. So the correct answer here is letter C. Riding a tricycle is an activity done by your 3 years old. So letter C is the correct answer here. Then next, for question number 77, a mother of a 3-year-old tells a clinic nurse that the child is rebelling constantly and having temper tantrums. The nurse most appropriately tells the mother to A. Punish the child every time the child says no to change the behavior. B. Allow the behavior because this is normal at this age period. C. Set limits on the child's behavior. Or D. Ignore the child when this behavior occurs. So meron po siyang temper tantrums. So, not appropriate po yung ating letter D na ignore mo yung bata. Ignore the behavior but do not ignore totally the child. Tanda nyo po yan. So, ang pinakamainam ditong gawin natin is to set limits of the child's behavior. Especially mga unwanted behaviors na ginagawa niya. Like yung mga pag-umpog ng ulo, pananakit sa kanyang sarili. So, yun po yung ating iset na limit. So, do not point out na mali yung bata. Point out mo lang na mali ang pinapakita niyang behavior but not the child, okay? So, letter C is the correct answer here. Set limits to your child's behavior. Then next, for question number 78, the nurse would expect a 4-month-old to be able to A. Hold a cup, B. Stand with assistance, C. Lift head and shoulders, or D. Sit with back straight. 4 months pa lamang po yung bata dito, ha? So, take note, una nating tatanggalin dito yung ating letter D, sit with back straight. Kasi yung sit with back straight, ibig sabihin yan, sit alone na yan. It can sit unsupported. So, mali na po yung ating letter D. Then, next na tatanggalin natin dito is yung letter B. Kasi stand with assistance daw. So, pag stands with support or stand with assistance, that is 11 months old. Tandaan niyo yan. Kasi stand alone at 12 months, stand with support at 11 months. So, alin dito yung ating 4 months old? So, letter C is the correct answer. The baby here can lift head and shoulder kasi nagkakaroon na po siya dito ng head control. Okay? So, letter C is the correct answer kasi may head control na po yung bata. So, again, the correct answer for question number 78 is letter C, lift head and shoulder because the child here achieves head control. Okay? And next, for question number 79, the nurse explains that by the age of 6 months, an iron-rich formula should be offered because the infant has A, limited ability to produce red blood cells, B, ineffective digestive enzymes, or C, exhausted maternal iron stores, or D, need of the iron to support dentition. Okay, so take note ha, yung ating weaning process ay nagaganap po yan at the age of 6 months or more. Okay, pero usually, 4 months pa lang yung bata ay pwede na tayong mag-solid feedings kasi the earliest time to administer your solid foods is 4 months. Kasi at 4 months, medyo nawawala na po yung mga stored iron at mga nutrients sa katawan ni baby na kung saan yun ang nakuha niya during your pregnancy of your mother. So, kailangan natin mag-administer ng mga iron-rich formula kasi nga, exhausted na yung maternal iron stores sa katawan ni baby. So, letter C is the correct answer for question number 79. Again, so medyo nagde-deplete na po ang iron na naitago or na-store sa katawan ni baby from the age of 4 months. And for question number 80, the nurse is planning a meal that would provide iron for child with bleeding disorders. So, which dinner menu would be the best? A, chicken nuggets, macaroni, and peas cantaloupe with milk. B, fish sticks, french fries, banana cookies, and milk. C, grounded beef patty, lima beans, and wheat roll, raisins, and milk. Or D, peanut butter and jelly sandwich, apple slices, and milk. So, alin dito yung mga iron-rich foods natin, okay? So, take note, kapag sinabi natin iron-rich foods, always remember your 4L. Number 1 is your lean meats or the liver, yan. L for liver, and your number 2L is the lean meats or the red meats. Number 3L is your leafy green vegetables and number 4 is the legumes, okay? So, mga legumes natin. So, again, so alin dito yung may mga red meats, may mga legumes, ayan, okay? So, napaka-obvious po ng sagot natin dito. Kasi ang sagot natin sa ating question number 80 ay letter C. So, yung letter C kasi, these are foods rich in iron, okay? So, letter C, especially yung grounded beef patty, yung pasas, at yung ating lima beans. Lima beans is a legumes, okay? So, these are foods rich in iron. So, that is the correct answer, okay? So, that is a common board question po yan at lumalabas po palagi yan. So, usually, incorporate po yan lagi sa mga tanong about your hemophilia, yung mga anemia, yan, okay? So, letter C po ang tamang sagot dyan, okay? So, next na tanong natin is number 81. So, number 81, Nico is a child diagnosed with hemophilia, has slip on the ice, and bump his knee. So, which among the following should Nurse Apple prepare to administer as per doctor's order? Intravenous infusion of A, cryoprecipitate, B, factor 8, C, factor 10, or D, desmopressin. Okay, so, meron tayo ditong case of hemophilia, and this type is your classic type of hemophilia, which is the hemophilia A, okay? So, pag meron po tayong hemophilia, dalawang klase yan, hemophilia A at hemophilia B, yan yung mga common dyan. Hemophilia A is your type of hemophilia with missing factor of number 8. So, clotting factor number 8 is missing to hemophilia A. At yung hemophilia B naman natin, kung saan tinatawag din natin siyang factor 9 deficiency or the Christmas disease, ay yun naman po yung missing factor niya is factor number 9, okay? So, yun naman ating hemophilia B. So, sa hemophilia A, ang ibibigay natin dyan usually is your factor number 8. So, this question is NCLEX-based po yan. So, makikita mo po yan sa libro ng ating NCLEX, which is ang sagot po doon is letter B, factor 8 po ang sagot natin dito sa ating situation na to. So, take note, sa board exam, nababago pong pangalan, napaparaphrase lamang po yung mga NCLEX question natin. So, this is an 8, na number 81 is an example of your NCLEX-based question. So, the correct answer here is letter B, factor 8, not factor 10, not desmopressin, and not cryoprecipitate. Kasi may mga nagsasabi kasi na ang sinasagot daw is yung ating cryoprecipitate. Mali po yun. Ang sagot po dito is your factor number 8. Kasi nga, yan po ang kulang na clotting factor sa kanila. So, factor number 8 po ang ating sagot sa ating hemophilia. Again, sa hemophilia A, kulang sila sa factor number 8. Sa hemophilia B, kulang naman po sila sa factor number 9. Okay, the next question is question number 82. When counseling parents of a child who has recently been diagnosed with hemophilia, what must Nurse Apple know about Nico's condition whose father is normal and the mother is the carrier. Tandaan niyo po yan. Si tatay ay normal. So, ibig sabihin niya, wala po siyang hemophilia gene. Si nanay ang carrier ng ating gene. So, letter A, it is likely that all sons are affected. Letter B, there is 50% probability that sons will have the disease. Letter C, every daughter is likely to be a carrier. Or letter D, there is a 25% chance that a daughter will be carrier. So, alin po dito ang sagot natin kung ang tatay ay normal or wala po siyang hemophilia genes, pero yung nanay ay carrier ng hemophilia gene, okay? So, A, B, C, or D. So, take note, nurses and midwives, that in your hemophilia, the carrier of the gene that causes hemophilia is the X chromosome. Tada niyan. So, X chromosome po ang nagkakare ng ating X, ng ating gene that causes your hemophilia. So, if the mother is carrier of the hemophilia gene, and the father does not have hemophilia, there is 50% that each son will have hemophilia. Again, 50% chance that each son will have hemophilia. And there is also a 50% chance that each daughter will be a carrier of the hemophilia gene. Again, so pag ang nanay ay meron po tayong X gene na nagkukos ng hemophilia or dating sex recessive trait na hemophilia sa kanyang X gene, si nanay at si tatay ay wala, 50-50 po ang percent natin dito. 50% na pwedeng ang lalaki magiging anak nila ay merong hemophilia at 50% na mababaing anak nila ay magiging carrier ng ating hemophilia gene, okay? But if the father has hemophilia and the mother does not carry the hemophilia gene, all daughters, okay? All daughters is likely to be a carrier. Again, pag ang tatay ang merong X gene ng ating hemophilia, lahat po ng magiging anak nilang babae ay carrier na po ng ating hemophilia gene, okay? Again, kung si tatay ang carrier ng ating X gene for hemophilia, ang mga babae ay magiging carrier na po ng ating hemophilia gene at walang mga lalaki ang magkakaroon ng sakit na hemophilia. Other example is if the father does not have hemophilia and the mother does not carry the hemophilia gene, syempre wala sa kanila nagkikare ng hemophilia gene, edi wala din mga anak ang magkakaroon ng hemophilia or magkikarrier ng gene ng hemophilia. So dito sa ating question number 82, si nanay lang ang merong X gene, okay? X gene that causes your hemophilia. So ang mangyari po dito is 50-50% kapag si nanay lang meron at si tatay wala. 50% ng mga lalaki magkakaroon ng hemophilia disease and 50% din ng mga babae magkakaroon ng carrier sila ng gene ng hemophilia or X gene of hemophilia. Again, 50-50% po yan. 50% ng mga lalaki magkakaroon ng hemophilia disease at 50% ng mga babae magiging carrier ng hemophilia gene. So, ang tamang sagot po dito ay letter B. Letter B kasi there is 50% probability that sons will have the disease. Mali kasi ang letter D natin kasi there is 25% lang daw mali. It should be 50% also for the chance of a daughter that will be a carrier of your hemophilia gene. Okay? The next, number 83, a nasogastric tube is prescribed to be inserted for a child with severe head trauma. Diagnostic testing reveals that the child has basilar skull fracture. So, what should the nurse do next? So, take note, lumabas na po ito sa ating board exam. So, actually, ang ating NGTI contraindication po yan sa ating basilar skull fracture or kapag meron po tayong severe head trauma. Pero pag meron po tayong doctor's order for NGT, ang gagawin mo dito is to check the patency of airway first before nasogastric tube. So, letter B is the correct answer here. Again, so napaka-obvious po ng sagot. Siyempre, ang priority natin lagi dyan is airway muna. Kasi nga, lalong-lalo na meron siyang basilar skull fracture. Eh, yan po yung contraindication ng ating NGT insertion. Pero pag may doctor's order, siyempre, piliin mo yung pinaka-priority natin dyan or pinaka-importante sa ating choices. And that is your patency of airway. So, letter B is the correct answer for question number 83. Then next, for question number 84, physiologic jaundice among newborn babies usually occur on which of the following? It occurs A, within 24 hours from birth, B, 7 days after birth, C, upon birth, or D, between the second and third day after birth. So take note sa aking lecture, meron po tayong tinatawag na physiologic jaundice and the pathologic jaundice. So any yellowish discoloration of the newborn that occurs within the first 24 hours of life and after the 7 days of life of the newborn is known as the pathologic jaundice. So pag naging nanilaw po ang bata within the first 24 hours and after 7 days of life, that is pathologic jaundice. Because physiologic or normal jaundice occurs or appears or visible at the second or third day of life of the newborn. And it occurs, visibly occurs cephalocaudal from face to your extremities. So face, forehead, then trunk, then extremities po yung ating sequence of occurrence ng ating jaundice. So the correct answer here is letter D. It occurs between second and third day. And take note, nagpipik po yung jaundice niya at third day to fourth day and kailangan niya mag-disappear 5 to 7 days. More than 7 days, that is a pathologic jaundice na din. There is abnormalities na. Or yan na yung tatawag natin na breast milk jaundice or yung ating jaundice na nagkakos dyan is yung pregnadiol na substance sa breast milk ni nanay. Again, pag ito po ay physiologic jaundice, the onset of physiologic jaundice is second day or third day, kasi pag yung jaundice ay nakita mo within the first day or the first 24 hours of life of the newborn or after 7 days pa nag-appear yung jaundice, that is pathologic jaundice. Pero pag ang jaundice ay nakita mo second day, third day, that is the physiologic jaundice. At yung physiologic jaundice na yan, nagpipik po yan between 3 days to 4 days. Kasi that days, dyan nag-elevate ang bilirubin ni baby. And kailangan mawala din yung jaundice niya 5 to 7 days. And the correct answer here is letter D. Okay, then next, for question number 85, the parents of a 2-year-old tell the nurse that they are concerned because the toddler has started to use baby talk since the arrival of their new baby. The nurse should recommend that the parents A. ignore the baby talk. B. explain to the toddler that baby talk is for babies. C. tell the toddler frequently, you are a big kid now. Or letter D. encourage the toddler to practice more advanced patterns of speech. So ano gagawin natin? Nagbe-baby talk na naman po yung ating 2-year-old. So that is a sign of regression. Ibig sabihin na stress na naman yung bata. So take note, kapag ganito pong nagbe-baby talk ang ating mga toddler, ang gagawin po natin dito nanay and tatay ay ignore mo lang yun, okay? Letter A is the correct answer here. Ignore the baby talk, okay? Ignore the baby talk. Why? So, take note that baby talk is a sign of regression in the toddler. So, it should be ignored while praising the child for developmentally appropriate behaviors. So, regression is children's way of saying that they are expressing stress. So, the parents should not introduce new expectations and should allow the child to master the developmental task without criticism. So, ang pinakamainam na gawin mo kapag ang toddler ay nag-regress at nagsimula na namang mag-baby talk, ang gagawin natin dyan is to ignore, okay? To ignore and praise the child for the developmentally appropriate behaviors. Pero pag nagbe-baby talk po siya, ignore mo yung baby talking niya, okay? So, letter A is the correct answer for this item question, okay? Then next, for question number 86, healthy physical development is dependent upon nutrition, brain development, muscle, and bone. So, which of the following is not appropriate for physical development of a preschooler? A. Sleep 6 to 8 hours of sleep each day. B. Assist in brushing and flossing teeth. C. Gains 5 pounds per year or the eruption of the primary teeth. So, not appropriate po ang hinahanap natin dito sa ating physical development ng preschooler. So, tama po ang letter C. Appropriate po yan na dapat ang preschooler ay mag-gain po ng 5 pounds per year. So, the correct answer here in your question number 86 is letter A. It sleeps 6 to 8 hours of sleep each day daw. Mali po yan kasi, take note, for proper development of your mental and physical development of your preschoolers, they need an average of 12 hours of sleep per day. So, yung 6 to 8 hours, napakababa po ng kanilang tulog kapag 6 to 8 hours lang. So, the correct answer dapat is 12 hours po ang pinaka-average. So, more than 12 hours is okay. So, pinaka-average natin ng ating 12 hours of sleep per day. So, letter A, that is not appropriate for the physical and mental development of a preschool child. So, A po ang pinakatamang sagot dito. And then next, for question number 87, the clinic nurse reviews the record of an infant and notes that the healthcare provider has documented a diagnosis of suspected Hirschsprung's disease. The nurse reviews the assessment findings documented in the record, knowing that which symptom most likely led the mother to seek healthcare for the infant. A. Diarrhea. B. Projectile vomiting. C. Regurgitation of feedings. Or D. Foul-smelling ribbon-like stools. Okay, so Hirschsprung's disease po yan. So yung projectile vomiting, that is a classic hallmark sign po yan na isa ng ating pyloric stenosis. So mali po ang ating letter B. Yung letter C naman natin, regurgitation of feedings. So normal lamang pong mag-regurgitate ang mga bata. Okay? So diarrhea may be possible na cause dyan is gastroenteritis or mga celiac disease or mga malabsorption syndromes. Okay? So mali po ang letter A, letter B, and letter C. So the correct answer here is letter D, the foul-smelling ribbon-like stools. Kasi pag sinabi po natin Hirschsprung's disease, that is the aganglionic megacolon. So aganglion po siya. So A means absence of ganglion cells, which is responsible for the peristaltic movement of your colon. So isa pang sign na meron siyang Hirschsprung's disease, early sign is the failure of passing of your meconium within the first 24 hours of life. Okay, so bukod pa yung ating ribbon-like stools. So meron po tayong kanta dyan sa ating Hirschsprung's disease. Okay, so ang kanta po dyan, lagi po yung kinakanta sa mga review centers at mga schools. So ang kanta po natin dyan is Hirschsprung's disease, megacolon, aganglionic, ribbon-like stool. Okay, ulitin ko. Ang kanta po natin dyan is Hirschsprung's disease, megacolon, aganglionic, ribbon-like stool. Kasi nga, ribbon-like stool po ang pinaka-classic symptom ng ating Hirschsprung's disease. Okay? So the correct answer here is letter D. It is a foul-smelling, ribbon-like stool. Then next, for question number 88, after thorough physical examination to a child, laboratory and diagnostic test, the physician ordered an emergency open appendectomy due to a suspected ruptured appendicitis. This is done to prevent which of the following major complication of your appendicitis? A. Thrombosis, B. Sepsis, C. Perforation, or D. Bleeding. Okay, so ang tanong po dito is the major complication of your appendicitis. So take note, nurses and midwives, that appendicitis is caused by your fecalit obstruction into the lumen of your appendix. Again, ulitin ko, fecalit po ang nagkukos ng ating appendicitis. That is the most common cause of your appendicitis. It's your fecalit. Okay, so pag sinabi po natin appendicitis, ang pinaka major complications po niyan ay perforation of your appendix and the peritonitis and abscess development. Ulitin ko, major complications include your perforation, peritonitis, and abscess development. Tatlo po yan. Perforation, peritonitis, and abscess development. So, ang major complication po natin dyan is the gangrene or perforation of the appendix within 36 hours. So, pwede pong mangyari yung perforation within 36 hours. Okay? So, pwede pong mangyari yung ating gangrene or perforation of the appendix within 36 hours. And pwede din pong magkaroon tayo dito ng peritonitis. Okay? Peritonitis and abscess development. So, paano natin malalaman na meron siyang peritonitis? Common din po ito sa board exam kasi. So, take note that the universal sign of peritonitis is tenderness or a hard rigid abdomen. Pag tender or rigid yung abdomen niya, suspect for your peritonitis. And take note that the most common symptom of your peritonitis is pain. Okay? Pain po yan. Okay? So, tandaan natin, peritonitis is also a complication of your appendicitis, but the most common and the major complication is perforation of the appendix. Okay? So, perforation is the correct answer here. Then, sabi dito, kapag meron po tayong appendicitis, ang position of comfort po ng patient natin is lying with legs drawn up. Okay? So, pag tinanong ko sa board exam kung anong position ng patient natin to alleviate or to reduce your pain is lying with legs drawn up. So, drawing up position po tayo. So, lying with legs drawn up, it will help to relieve the pain on the abdominal muscles or the tension on the abdominal muscles. So, yun po yung pinaka most appropriate naman na position natin to relieve your abdominal pain in your appendicitis. Lying with legs drawn up. So, again, the correct answer for your question number 88 is letter C, perforation po ang pinaka major complication ng ating appendicitis. The next, number 89, the nurse admitted the child and started to do her assessment. What sign is elicited by the nurse when deep palpation of the left iliac fossa is done and causes pain on the right iliac fossa of the patient? So, alin po dito? A, obturator sign, B, Blumberg sign, C, psoas sign, or D, Robsing sign. So, dito sa ating question number 89, mag-eliminate muna tayo dito. So, una nating eliminate dito is yung Blumberg sign. Bakit? Ang Blumberg sign kasi, yan yung tinatawag natin na rebound tenderness. Okay? Rebound tenderness or the pain in the lower abdomen after a sudden, okay? After a sudden release of the hand from the lower abdominal quadrant. So, dito, pinapalpate mo yung kanyang lower abdomen. Then, kapag sudden na tinanggal mo yung palpation mo, yung kamay mo, bigla po siyang makakaramdam ng pain sa ating lower quadrant of the abdomen. And that is the Blumberg sign. Kaya siya tinawag na rebound tenderness. Okay? So, mali po yung ating letter B, mali po ang ating Blumberg sign. Then, next na tatanggalin natin dito is yung letter A, obturator sign. Kasi pag sinabi po natin obturator sign, there is a pain on passive rotation of the hip when the right knee is flexed. So, habang naka-flex yung right knee ng patient mo, then meron tayong passive rotation na ginagawa sa hip niya. So, nagkaroon po tayo ng obturator pain. So, ibig sabihin niya, nasasagi po ng obturator muscle ang inyong appendix. Kaya po siya sumasakit. So, that is a wrong answer din. The next, we have also your incorrect answer. We have your psoas sign. Kasi pag sinabi naman natin psoas sign, ang ginagawa naman natin dito is, yung patient pwede po siyang nakahiga at the left side. Then gagawin mo dito, i-extend mo yung kanyang right hip or i-flex mo yung right hip niya against resistance, then makakaramdam po siya dito ng right lower quadrant pain. Okay, so again, so yung psoas sign natin is a right lower quadrant pain with extension of the right hip or with flexion of the right hip against resistance. Ang position natin sa patient dito is left side. So, psoas sign naman po yun. So, pag ganito, kapag nagpalpate ka sa left iliac fossa, tapos nag-cause yan ng pain sa right iliac fossa, ang tawag natin dyan is Rovsing sign. So, letter D is the correct answer for question number 89. And take note, palagi po yan lumalabas sa board exam. Okay? Pwede sa NP2, pwede sa NP3, or pwede sa NP4 po yan lumabas. Again, so that is your Rovsing sign. So, palpation was done on the left iliac fossa and the pain was felt at the right iliac fossa of your patient. So, letter D is the correct answer for question number 89. And next, we have your question number 90. As a safety alert, which of the following nursing measures should be avoided by the nurse prior to appendectomy? A. Observe nothing by mouth or NPO. B. Administration of enema. C. Removal of nail polish. Or D. Instruct to urinate. So, tama po ang ating letter A. Tama din po ang ating letter D kasi nga maoperahan po siya bago pa tayo magbigay ng ating preoperative drugs or anesthesia. Dapat umihi muna siya. And letter C, removal of your nail polish kasi gagamitin natin yung nail niya for your oxygen saturation device assessment. So, the correct answer here is letter B, administration of enema. Bawal po mag-enema, okay? Bawal mag-enema kasi possible po yan na possible na mag-cause yan ng rupture of your appendix. Baka matamaan at ma-stimulate yung appendix, mag-spasm and mag-rupture po yung appendix. Ano pang bawal? Bawal din siya mag-take ng analgesic kapag sumasakit yung kanyang appendix. Okay? Kasi kapag sudden na nawala ang kanyang, yung kanyang pain na nararamdaman, hindi mo na malalaman kung nag-rupture na yung kanyang appendix. So, bawal mag-take ng ating analgesic or pain reliever. And bawal din pong mag-apply ng warm compress. Okay? Bawal yung hot water bag. And do not perform your frequent palpation onto your abdomen. Especially sa ating area na masakit sa ating appendicitis. Okay? So, mali po yan. So, the correct answer here is your letter B. Okay? So, bawal pong mag-introduce or mag-perform ng enema sa may patient na may appendicitis. So, there is a risk of your rupture of your appendix. So, letter B is the correct answer for question number 90. The next for question number 91, which of the following condition is not included among the effects of cold stress? A. Hypoglycemia. B. Metabolic acidosis. C. Increased intracranial pressure. Or D. Cerebral palsy. This is a common board question, okay? So, palagi po itong lumalabas sa NP2. So, the correct answer here is letter C. Increased intracranial pressure. Bakit? So, letter C ang sagot natin dito, increased intracranial pressure kasi common na pwedeng mangyari kapag may cold stress sa newborn is hypoglycemia, metabolic acidosis, hypothermia, and syempre, pwedeng mag-lead din po yan ng cerebral palsy. Why? Kasi yung hypoglycemia, it may occur due to the increased metabolic rate. And because of the newborns are born slightly acidic, they can catabolize brown fat, which will produce ketones, which is an acid will cause metabolic acidosis. Yung ating brown fat, kapag ginamit yun ni baby to produce body heat, it causes your ketone production. And yung ketone na yun ay isang acid po yan. And that causes your metabolic acidosis state. So hindi po alkalosis, acidosis po. Then, yung newborn na merong severe hypothermia, at risk din po yan sa kernicterus or too much bilirubin in the brain that can lead to cerebral palsy. Okay? So, wala pong relationship or wala pong connection yung ating hypothermia or yung ating cold stress sa increased ICP ng bata. So, mali pong ating increased intracranial pressure. So, letter C is the correct answer for question number 91. Then next, for question number 92, hypothermia is common in preterm newborns because of their inability to control heat. Which of the following is an exception to the appropriate nursing intervention to prevent heat loss? Exception to appropriate nursing intervention. So, ibig sabihin yan, mga inappropriate na. So, ang hinahanap na natin dito is the inappropriate nursing intervention. Kasi exception po. A. Using mechanical pressure. B. Drying and wrapping the baby. C. Placing the crib beside the wall, or D. Doing kangaroo care. So, alin dito yung exception natin for your appropriate nursing intervention to prevent heat loss? So, A, B, and D are appropriate nursing intervention, except letter C, placing the crib beside the wall. Why? Kasi take note po, meron po tayong mga methods of heat loss known as your convection, conduction, radiation, and your evaporation. So, pag nilagay mo po yung crib ni baby beside the wall, it can cause your radiation heat loss. Kapag yung wall na yun ay malamig, pwede pong mag-cause yun ng heat loss sa katawan ni baby by means of radiation. Okay? So, mali po yung ating letter C na nilagay mo yung crib ni baby near the wall. So, dapat malayo po yan sa open drafts like the open windows, open doors, and sa mga wall, okay? Dapat malayo po siya doon para maiwasan natin yung mga methods of heat loss like convection sa open doors and windows, and yung ating method of heat loss sa ating radiation, example is your cold walls. Okay, so letter C is the correct answer here kasi except po ang tinatanong natin dito. Okay, then next, number 93, a nurse is discussing childhood cancer with the parents of a child in an oncology unit. So which statement by the nurse would be the most accurate? A. The most common site for children's cancer is the bone marrow. B. All childhood cancers have a high mortality rate. C. Children with leukemia have higher survival rate if they are older than 11 when diagnosed. Or letter D. The prognosis for children with cancer isn't affected by treatment strategies. So, appropriate statement po. Most accurate ang ating tinatanong dito. So, between A, B, C, and D, ang pinaka-accurate dyan na ating isasagot is letter A. That the most common site for your children's cancer is the bone marrow. Kasi ang pinaka-common na cancer ng mga bata is leukemia. And that is a cancer of your bone marrow, sa ating dugo. So, letter A is the correct answer for your question number 93. Okay, so A po yan. Napaka-obvious po ng sagot dyan. A is the correct answer here. Then next, question number 93. A nurse was giving a workshop on the proper implementation of the Unang Yakap campaign in a certain barangay when one of the participants asked why this protocol is so important. The nurse correctly tells the participant that A. Unang Yakap emphasizes a core sequence of action performed methodically. B. Unang Yakap is organized so that essential time-bound interventions are not interrupted. Or C. It fills a gap for a package of bundled interventions in a guideline format. Or D. All of the above. So, why that this Unang Yakap protocol is so important? So, actually, A, B, C are all correct answers. So, the correct answer here is letter D. So, pwede mong sabihin yan sa ating mga participants. A, B, and C. Pwede po yan. These are correct or appropriate statement na pwede mong i-share about your Unang Yakap protocol. So, dog is the correct answer for your question number 94, okay? So, all of the above po yan. Next, number 95. Nurse Andrea observed other details as essential part of the immediate care of the normal newborn, which included A. Skin-to-skin contact followed by incubation. No, kasi hindi naman natin in-incubate yung bata kasi skin-to-skin contact lamang po yan. Uninterrupted, okay? Uninterrupted skin-to-skin contact. B. Stimulating by slapping the baby's buttocks. No, you can be charged up battery. Bawal na pong stimulate yung bata para lang umiyak. C. Removing used cloth and replacing with dry cloth. Or D. Deep suctioning of the airway to remove mucus. Mali na rin ang ating letter D kasi that is not a routine procedure for every birth. Okay, mali na po ang ating suctioning. Di na po yan ginagawa sa ngayon. Unnecessary procedure na po yan. So, the correct answer for question number 95 is letter C, removing used cloth and replacing with dry cloth. That is to prevent your hypothermia to the newborn and to maintain dryness of the newborn to prevent cold stress. So, letter C is the correct answer for question number 95. Next, number 96. The patient has been seen crying and irritable. As her nurse, you know that patient is experiencing baby blues. So, which is the best description of her condition? It is condition in which the patient experiences some feelings of A, excitement, B, euphoria, C, sadness, or D, anxiety. So, pag sinabi po natin blue, blue is a sad emotion, okay? So, the feeling of blue is sadness. So, the correct answer here is letter C. Postpartum blues po yan. So, C is the correct answer here. So, usually, ang postpartum blues ay nakikita po natin yan second day or third day postpartum. And that is normal, okay? So, provide comfort, provide support lamang po tayo dyan. No medication to treat your postpartum blues kasi normal lamang po yan. That is effect of your sudden decrease in your estrogen and progesterone hormone after your delivery. Lumabas po yung lahat ng sinabi ko. Sudden decrease of your hormone estrogen and progesterone, that is the cause of your postpartum blues. Lumabas na po yun. And kailan mo siya nakikita? Second day or third day. Okay? So yun po. And peaks at fifth day and kailan mawala po yan at tenth day. So dapat hindi siya lumagpas ng 2 weeks. Kasi pag lumagpas ng 2 weeks yan, that is now known as the postpartum depression. Okay? And then next, for question number 97, a client vital signs following delivery are, day 1 is BP is 116 over 72 with temperature of 98.6 and pulse rate of 68. At day 2, BP is 114 over 80, temperature of 100.6, pulse is 76. And day 3 is 114 over 80 BP, 101.6 temperature and 80 pulse rate. So the nurse should suspect which of the following about the client's status. A, is dehydrated. B, may have an infection. C, has normal vital signs. Or D, is going into shock. Okay, so sa ating vital signs, sa ating day 1, lahat po yan ay normal range pa. But in day 2 and day 3, abnormal na po yung ating temperature dito. Ang temperature na sa ating day 2 is 100.6, which is may fever na po yung patient natin dyan. Lalong-lalo na sa day 3, mataas na po yung lagnat niya, 101.6 na. So, sa ating vital signs dito, para malaman mo yung ating conversion ng ating Fahrenheit sa ating Celsius, kasi lumalabas din naman yan sa board exam, ang gagawin mo lang dito, nurses and midwives, is kung binigyan ka ng Fahrenheit, ang gagawin mo sa Fahrenheit na binigay is mag-minus ka or mag-subtract ka lang ng 32, then i-divide mo siya sa 1.8. So, pag ang given dito sa ating day 2 is 100.6 degrees Fahrenheit, 100.6 degrees Fahrenheit minus 32 divided by 1.8 is equal to 38.1 degrees Celsius. And may lagnat na po yan kasi lumagpas na ng 38. And yung day 3 naman niyang 101.6, pag ang ginawa mo naman is i-convert mo siya sa ating Celsius, 101.6 minus 32 divided by 1.8. Saan ko kinuha yung 32 tsaka divided by 1.8? Constant na po yan. Tandaan mo na lang po yan, okay? Pag magko-convert ka ng Fahrenheit to degrees Celsius. Fahrenheit minus 32 divided by 1.8. Okay? Siyempre, Fahrenheit minus 32, then pag gumagamit ka ng calculator, mag-equals ka lagi. So, degrees Fahrenheit minus 32 equals divided by 1.8. Ganun po yun para makuha mo yung sagot natin. So, sa ating day 3 na 101.6, 101.6 minus 32 equals divided by 1.8 is equal to 38.6 degrees Celsius. So, may lagnat po ang patient natin dito. And take note that fever is a sign of infection. Tandaan yan. So, fever is a sign of infection. So, kung ang body temperature ni nanay sana is 100.1, 100.2, 100.3, or 100.4. Basta hindi po siya lalagpas ng 100.5, pwede mong isagot dito yung dehydration or maternal exhaustion lang or na-dehydrate lang si nanay. Kasi usually yun naman talaga yung nagbabagong vital signs postpartum. Nag-slightly increase naman talaga yung kanilang body temperature due to your maternal exhaustion and dehydration. Pero dito sa nakita natin, masyadong mataas yung itinaas ng kanyang body temperature, especially at the day 3. And that is 38.6 na yan. So, mataas na po yan. And that is a sign now of your infection, okay? So, lalong-lalo na kapag nasamahan pa yan ng ating foul-smelling vaginal discharge, baka meron na po siya diyang puerperal sepsis like your endometritis. So, the correct answer here is a sign of infection, and that is letter B. May have an infection. So, letter C, mali po yan. Letter D, mali po yan. Kasi sa shock po natin, dapat hypotaki-taki. Hypotension, tachycardia, and tachypnea. So, letter B is the correct answer for question number 97. Then next, for question number 98, what is the condition of Ivana if pinkish red or reddish vaginal, reddish brown colored vaginal discharge is continuing to occur after 3 to 4 weeks after birth with fever, pain, and abdominal tenderness? A. Vaginitis, C. Cervicitis, C. Mastitis, or D. Endometritis. Again, ang kulay na po is reddish brown colored, okay? Then, nag-continue po yan 3 to 4 weeks with fever and pain and abdominal tenderness. So, these are classic signs of your puerperal sepsis known as your metritis or the endometritis. So, the correct answer here is letter D. Not vaginitis, not cervicitis. That is a sign of endometritis. Kasi ang ating vaginitis, meron dapat yung itchiness, pruritus vulva also, okay? So, dog is the correct answer here, okay? Not mastitis kasi breast po yung affected dyan. So, walang kinalaman yung abdominal tenderness dapat. And for question number 99, the space of the menstrual cycle that promotes the uterine lining to grow and thicken to an 8 to 10-fold rate is which of the following? Menstruation, proliferative, ischemic, or the secretory? So, take note, meron po dito ang thickening na nangyayari sa inyong endometrial lining, and that is caused by your estrogen hormone. And the estrogenic phase of your menstrual cycle under the uterine cycle is the proliferative phase. Kaya nga tinawag na proliferative kasi proliferate means to increase in cell size and to increase in your cell number. So, it renews or it regenerates the lining of the uterus at your proliferative phase. Okay, so the correct answer here is letter B, proliferative. Kasi sa menstruation, that is the thinning and the sloughing of the stratum basalis or the stratum functionalis of your endometrium. Okay? So, the stratum functionalis of your endometrium is being sloughed off kasi walang estrogen, walang progesterone na mag-maintain sa kanyang lining. So, kapag kumakapal na po siya, that is under now your proliferative phase. At pag sinabi naman natin ischemic phase, that is the phase where the cells of your endometrium or the lining is again degenerating. Kapag nag-degenerate po yan, nagkaroon po dito ng lack of oxygen and blood supply, kaya nag-degenerate and babalik na naman po siya sa menstruation. Kasi pag sinabi mong ischemic phase, that is the premenstrual phase kung saan nagde-degenerate din po dyan yung corpus luteum. And kapag sinabi naman po nating secretory phase, dyan naman po ang tinatawag natin na progesteronic phase of your uterine cycle of the menstrual cycle. Kasi this is the most ideal time for your pregnancy or implantation of your blastosis. Secretory phase naman po yun, okay? So, progesteronic phase is the secretory phase. Proliferative phase is the estrogenic phase where there is an increase in your lining or thickening of the lining of the uterus. And that is in response of your estrogen hormone. And finally, last number na po tayo, number 100, the newly hired nurse asks for advice from the supervisor. Supervisor notices that the newly hired nurse felt uneasy upon learning that the fetus is on breech presentation. So, which of the following is the best response by the supervisor? A. I understand how you feel. Tell me more. B. Is this your first time to witness a breech presentation? C. Are you afraid to assist the case? Or D. Don't worry. There's always a first time. So, don't worry is false reassurance yan. Pangit yan. Non-therapeutic na po yan. So, ang pinaka most therapeutic response dito is letter A, I understand how you feel, tell me more. Okay, so take note, lumabas daw po yan last board exam at lagi po yan lumalabas sa board exam. Yung letter A natin, that is a common board question. Okay, so question number 100, pinaka common na sagot natin dyan is letter A because that is the most therapeutic answer or response sa ating situation. I understand how you feel. Tell me more. Oh, di ba? Napaka-therapeutic po nun. Okay? So, dyan na po nagtatapos ang ating rationalization ng ating obstetrics and pediatrics. So, sa lahat po naman nag-participate ngayong gabi, maraming salamat po sa inyong oras at sa mga nagbigay po ng kanilang super chat and super sticker support. Thank you very much po at abangan nyo na lamang po ang aking shoutout sa aking susunod na mga online events. Okay? So dito na po nagtatapos ang ating online rationalization. Pasensya na po at medyo tayo ay medyo na late na po tayo natapos ngayong gabi. Still, I hope na marami po kayong natutunan, and kung meron po kayong natutunan na bago or kayo po yung natuto ngayong gabi, I would like to read your comments below, okay? So gustong-gusto ko pong magbasa ng comments, lalong-lalo na po yung ating mga suggestions or kung ano yung mga natutunan nyo sa aking previous videos or itong event natin ngayong gabi. Kung meron kang natutunan, i-share mo naman sa amin sa baba, okay? So just comment below and masaya po akong nagbabasa ng comments, okay? So maraming salamat po and have a good night everyone and keep safe always.